Hello and welcome back to Heroes of the Dorm 2016. My name is Cloaken, joined by Trixler and Solid Jake on this Easter Sunday. Thank you for joining us. We are here with the Epic Gate. One game down, three more to go. That was an incredible game, guys.
That was a great game, a great series already. It's a great way to start out the day with a match that's fun to watch. I love that we actually saw Cap Berkeley starting to fight back a little bit in game number two, but UConn is just a dominance force right there. I know we were talking to Jake a little bit earlier, but he's feeling pretty confident about
UConn. Yeah, you know, I will say my bracket took a hit that matchup. I did predict Cal to move on. But
I told you. You just didn't believe.
I know.
You didn't believe.
We should believe Jake more often.
730 points, though, boys.
Oh, man.
What's your point score?
Let's not talk about it.
Okay.
I'm probably like low 400. I think I'm like 420 or something like that, 430 around that area.
Man,
I'm just getting destroyed. Boston College in bracket A. They let me down.
I'm in second to last right now. I'm at 610. Gilly's at 650, but I think I might be passing here today. So.
Yeah, that UConn pickup. Nice move there for you, Jake. Okay, well, let's turn our attention to the next match of the day. Here we have Washington Hot Dogs versus Tennessee Wheat Ballin. Gentlemen, take me through these two teams. What should we be paying attention to?
Washington is a team that I feel like has been destroying their matches. This is a team that really prioritizes team fighting and really breaking their opponents down with pure synergy and pure teamwork. Now, they know that their weakness was objectives, and they've gotten much better at it, especially yesterday in the Super 16. So we'll be watching for them. Now, Tennessee is a team that you watched yesterday, Jake. Rafflecopter is looking pretty good, but he's got some follow-up.
We'll get them to a minute. University of Washington, these guys really making some waves right now in this tournament. They came in, people expect them to do all right, but they're the number 8th seed. They are the lowest seeded team from the qualifiers in this tournament still left.
Yeah, I still think people are doubting their play, but we have just seen nothing but greatness. That eyeshiny gray mane is remarkable, and of course they've been getting so much value out of Zagara's Maws. You know, teams are starting to wise up. They were starting to see some bans come on that Zagara play against them. So we'll see how they strategize with maybe some of those tools away from them in this ban phase.
Alrighty, but then we have Tennessee and Rafflecopter. Yes, he's kind of a household name in competitive heroes, but he's not the only one. Gutslug is the one calling the shots. He's in your face with those melee assassins. And Frumgore has over 4,000 games played. Like, that is monstrous.
That is monstrous.
A lot of games.
Yeah.
Wow.
And you know, these guys, they're friends. They've been playing heroes quite a bit. You know, BYD, this guy loves Heroes of the Storm so much and supporting his team so much. He's been playing from the library at their university because he doesn't have strong internet at home. So just an interesting little tidbit about their team. Amazing that they have circumstances like that and yet are playing so well. These guys still have, they've lost one game in this entire tournament so far.
Yeah.
Very strong play, and of course all centered around Rafflecopter as the center core.
Yeah, for me that's what it was. I thought it was going to be Rafflecopter and the boys. That's what I thought it would be. Yeah. They would just be backing him up, more of like, I don't know, background dancers, but they are not. They're actually in the front line making plays, especially Gutslug. Gutslug was a guy that we were watching, and the confidence that emanated from his gameplay was so wonderful, and I love watching it, and I hope to see more from him, because Rafflecopter is kind of doing a few things here to make a plays when necessary for his team, but he's definitely not carrying them. He's actually on the back just kind of working together with his team, and I love it.
Yeah, that is for sure. Gutslug with the Thrall, those Sun Rings have been working very, very well for them. And we're going to find out just shortly. You know what's interesting, though, to talk about the mindset of Tennessee. I think, you know, when we had them on the phone earlier this week, they were a little bit surprised about the fact that things have been working so well for them. They, you know, as you mentioned, Rafflecopter, a very strong player, but they even themselves didn't know exactly how their team synergy was going to come together. And I think as we move deeper and deeper into this tournament, they're getting these wins under their belt. They're getting more and more confident. We're seeing more of these other players realize that they have what it takes to be a top competitor in this tournament. And that's so fun to watch.
And I got to give a big shout out to their sub, Merton, because Merton is actually doing a ton of research for the team. Every time they draft, he's sitting there helping them out, giving them advice, giving them his input, because he's a very strategic player. Maybe not the most mechanic. That's probably why he's in the sub role. But when it comes to his brains, he's a huge asset for this team.
Yeah,
it's a really huge asset. A lot of subs that are in this tournament are really just kind of there. I'm here if you need me, guys. But someone putting so much work into it and being hands-on is such an asset. You can see it in the play of Tennessee. So very cool that is occurring.
Absolutely. Well, let's turn our attention to the first map in this match. It's going to be on Dragonshire. Jake, can you walk us through this one?
Oh, yeah. Well, Dragonshire, of course, will be our first map every day today. And this is a standard tri lane where we tend to see those strong, powerful solo laners sitting in the top lane while we have a four-man rotating between mid and bottom. Of course, there's many mercenary camps. And of course, if you're able to channel both of the shrines, you have the ability to capture the Dragon Knight and use it for your power. One hero will drive in the seat of this Dragon Knight and do massive damage to the opponent's structures. And if you're lucky, you can win the game.
Yeah, I'm actually watching Washington on this battleground because we talked about it earlier. Their team fights are really good, but in the round of 32, I believe we saw them play this battleground, and they won it because of a couple of great devouring mauls. But in terms of actual spreading out and working together as a team, I feel like they're lacking a little bit on this battleground in particular. Now, they did mention they're working their objectives, and we saw it yesterday at Super 16, but I want to see more work from them. I want to see more teamwork across the map, not just in team fights, because not working the objectives is a sure way to lose in this tournament.
Yeah, for
sure. So we'll keep an eye on it.
Well, let's take another close look at this battleground and the action that we've seen to date on Dragonshire. This is a heat map of all kills, deaths that have occurred on this battleground throughout the course of the entire tournament. So a lot of it there centered in the middle of the map.
Right. We talked about that 4-1, and this is because you're going to have literally 2 out of 10 sitting in the top lane for the majority of the game, and the other 8 players are going to constantly try to catch each other off guard between the middle and the bottom lane.
Yeah, you're going to see a lot of movement from that middle and the bottom lane. The top lanes, again, we saw it last game in our match. We actually saw Thrall versus Agara. There are a couple of heroes that can do pretty well up there. We've seen Rexxar before, but again, these are heroes that aren't played by these teams. So usually you'll see Zagara, Thrall, and Zul, the top 3 that are really contested for that area, while the rotations that Jake was talking about comes a little bit later on.
Well, let's take a look at these teams. How well have they studied each other's play in the previous rounds? We're going to find out right now as we jump into the draft on this game 1. With Dragonshire.
Alrighty, well, you know, oftentimes we do see those strong lane heroes prioritized in the ban phase, and Zagara, she is the perfect case for that.
Yeah, just take her away. Get her away from Washington. When it comes to Zagara, they are really strong, really patient. They play backwards. They love the Zagara into Gray Mane combo. Sometimes you'll see the Devouring Maul into more stunning, but Washington loves the Zagara into we kill you with Gray Mane with the slashes. So Tyrande, though, immediately banned out here for Washington.
Yeah, you know, we haven't seen a ton of Tyrande play from Tennessee in this tournament, but that doesn't mean either Washington has a potentially a build or a comp in mind that they know that could be weak against Tyrande. We will see.
Now, Tyrande gives you just a really strong level 1. She gives you this like huge, diverse pool of heroes that pair nicely with her for the strong rotations, and they take that away. But Falstad, global presence, we've seen the power of that hero throughout this event. And then, Tim, you mentioned Zul. There he is.
Yep, Zul will most likely be in that top lane. He can be very good for engaging. I like the ban on Tyrande, though, because we did see Tennessee a lot of time in the early rounds prioritizing vision over
vision
fight.
Sure.
So taking away the vision from them really diminishes their ability to adapt and really look at how the map is laying out and make decisions based on that. So a good pickup on the Tyrande ban, getting Zul and Muradin. They now have initiation like crazy. They have Bone Prison and they have Stormbolt, both abilities that are relatively easy to land, especially if that Bone Prison goes first, and then you can, of course, get the amplified damage at 16 to really help out Greymane if Greymane gets picked up. From Tennessee, they're going to go for Thrall and Rhaegar. I would love to see a Greymane pickup here from Washington, or I think Tennessee will ban it out.
Yeah, Thrall going to be that strong lane presence that's going to probably be battling well against Zul. We're seeing bans come out here for Washington in the mid phase. This is Johanna being taken off of the table. A strong tank. We've seen her had a remarkable presence in this tournament to date, serving up as a good center point for team that condemn the control that comes from her, her ability to lane clear as well. Not necessarily the most important component here on Dragonshire as it would be on smaller maps like Tomb of the Spider Queen, but, you know.
She's also very good for the rotation. So just a quick lane clear, she's great for that. But the Greymane ban, you mentioned it. iShiny has played Greymane 9 games in this tournament so far. So taking that incredibly powerful hero out of his hands, probably a smart call.
Yeah, these bans are both smart from both teams. One, Johanna breaks through that Zul and that Muradin relatively easy. The Bone Prison is hard to follow up on when Johanna has that Iron Skin. So now they have the ability to really find an opponent. If they catch him, they can kill him. Karazim and Tacitor are being picked up. Are we going to get an Illidan game from Washington?
That would be very cool. And of course, you talked about Vision earlier. You know, they're doing a good job of owning that. They picked up Tacitor, so Tyrande's gone, Zagara's gone. Now they have Tacitor, so a lot of the vision tools almost completely in the hands of Washington.
Yeah, if I'm Tennessee, I'm looking at this, I'm saying, all right, it's Illidan as a 5th pick. What do we pick here to make sure that we don't get wrecked by Illidan? ETC is a good start there. You can get the power slides, you get the mosh pits, you have the potential to get a value mosh pit. Also, a really, really good warrior again to be here. I love double warrior against Illidan because you can kind of slow him down with his constant pushing and really dictate how a teamfight will go out if you can draw it out. But Lenara is actually the pickup here from Tennessee. What is Washington going to pick up?
It can't be Illidan. Yeah. Illidan's way too risky. They don't have a ranged assassin. It's way too all-in to do that. And the risk of power slide, mosh pit, the massive value from the Thornwood Vine when you're clumping up to engage and stuff, and the fact that Lenara can slow everyone.
What do you pick up, though, here? You're so all-in on this engage. raging comp already. What is a pickup if you're here, Jake? The range assassin. Which range assassin do you think
Jaina wouldn't
here?
Be bad. Vala wouldn't be bad. They're both fine in these kind of situations. They're both two safe picks that have an escape mechanic. And I think either could be fine.
I think I like Vala more of the two options you gave there. You get the auto attacks in there. If you have a strong mechanical player like Ice Shiny on there, you can work your way through the opposing team. Lenara is pretty scary, but Jimmy. Rainer is a pickup.
Yeah, Jimmy coming in, of course. Great auto attack hero there, and his control, his ability to sort of zone out teams with the use of the Hyperion, and, you know, some good self-sustain there with Adrenaline Rush. Maybe that's going to free up their support to pay attention to some of their other heroes.
So Inspire will be key here. We're going to see if Rainer will be getting that Revolution Overdrive and really trying to help his entire team just move forward and engulf the opposing team.
I mean, I think Oshoyu has played Rainer more than any other player in this entire tournament.
Sure.
So this is a very confident pick for them. It makes sense for that last slot when you consider the threat that exists of the Mosh Pit. If Rainer's left out of there, he's just going to use the Penetrating Round and stop the Mosh Pit, and it's just a great response to have.
Yeah, and Tassadar being the healer here isn't actually that big of a deal. He can just get the shields out because Rainer already has Adrenaline Rush, so he's able to heal himself up. Muradin has his own form of self-sustain as well, and then you have Karazim that can work on the auto attacks and just help out the team overall. I kind of like this comp, but it is one that's going to be super aggressive. I like the Lenara counterpick because Lenara is able to poke like crazy and kite backwards, and then when they get to a breaking point where they can actually start breaking down Washington, then they turn around the entire fight with the Sundering and try and get in there and get really a lot of that damage out. But this is going to be a fun match to watch already just by looking at the draft.
Well, I think we should jump right into it right now. Game is ready. Here it is. Game one, Washington versus Tennessee. Who's going to take it here on Dragonshire? Tim, introduce us to the blue team.
The far left, the Washington Hot Dogs. Eye Shiny, Terror, Shoyu, Shogun, the Twins, and Sharsnik at the very bottom there are going to be repping that Tassadar. All right, on the very far right.
The Kevin. Right side, Tennessee. We've all in. This is Gutslug on Thrall. BYD on Rhaegar, Mathdiz with ETC, Falstad driving Rafflecopter, or the other way around, and Frumgar playing Lunara.
All right, so we're going to see how the match will open up here. I'm thinking that the Hot Dogs will play a little bit more reserved. Mathdiz can come in there and get a really strong power slide. Usually you see a lot of teams head up in the middle. And the interesting thing is we've always seen Zagar on this map. The teams don't have to push out at the very beginning for level 1 and get that creep tumor down. So they can do two things. They can play passively, just make sure they don't get engaged on, or they can go for a quick experience lead by getting a kill.
All right, well, we have seen so much power out of Falstad on maps like Dragonshire. Let's see if Rafflecopter can get just as much value as we've seen in previous matches, even today on this battleground. Right now, we're just seeing the team settle into the typical 1-4 that we see. One hero in the top lane, four that will rotate between mid and bottom lane. How are you guys feeling? Do you think Raffle will be able to pull out some of the magical plays that we've seen on Falstad here?
I don't know if he'll be necessarily Michael Udall status, but he certainly is a very talented player, and if there's anyone that can live up to those expectations, it's him. But one thing I want to mention is the fact that we're not actually seeing Zul in the solo lane. The fact that it's Tassadar controlling that, Zul's going to be a great asset for that Bone Prison to try to catch people out of, you know, out of their lanes.
Well, it also tells me that Washington doesn't really care about the top lane. They don't mind losing it. They just want to get the soak there and have Zul control the middle and the bottom lane, help out with the engagement that Jake mentioned, and just control the entire bottom shrine. If they control the bottom shrine, especially with Zul being here, they're able to control the mercenaries. So they are all about owning the middle and the bottom lane and just allowing Tassadar to sit up top and just stay alive.
Shrines have spawned in the top and bottom portions of the map. If you can control both, you will get access to the Dragon Knight in the middle, so we will begin to see that tug and pull war happen across the top and bottom right now. Of course, Dragon Knight available for the red team, but blue team rotating down to respond with Frumgor and Rafflecopter trying to defend.
Wow, Rafflecopter and Frumgor really working on those auto attacks in a 2v3 there. Rainer not really putting out the damage quite yet. And by the way, he did pick up Seasoned Marksman, so Rainer is going to be hitting like a truck in the late game. So keep an eye on that as he's going to continue farming and rotating with his team here as they grab as many Marksman stacks as they can.
Right, this is actually one of the best battlegrounds in the entire game for Seasoned Marksman, just because in these scenarios where you're getting two full lanes of soak, that makes it ramp up far more quickly than a map, say, like Cursed Hollow.
Shiny in trouble here will be used to, will be forced to use his bone armor here, and he just turns around, and with help of Tassadar, Thrall is going to be the first blood.
You just see the power there right now of Zul's number one key, his bone armor. You know, he has it always available, and you just saw him commit fully. He knew he had the backup from Sharsnik to get that cool. That was really cool.
It's smart play. He held it to try to make that Thrall feel like he was able to stay and trade out, and then as soon as he realized he needed to cast it, he used it at the last possible moment.
Yeah, because at that point, the opposing team is probably going for the all in there. They use all their engagements and really work out. So you're right. Very smart play there by Zulterra and Shoyu working down here in tandem, trying to break down this bottom lane here, get some damage on Lunara, but she can be quite frisky as she jumps around a lot there. Very quick movement speed. In the middle of the lane here, we do have Muradin and Zul trying to help out with the pushing. They just want to push this in as hard as they can. Drain that infrastructure ammo, get those turrets very, very low, and allow for the mid game to a point where you can take those towers and grab experience.
So it doesn't look like we're seeing much of a hybrid Taskstar. He's going for the support style with Leeching Plasma. He'll go for Collar's Embrace level 7 most likely. But Zul is going for a Spectral Scythe style. Oftentimes we see more into the Jailers with all the additional presence on all the skeletons, but not at all the case. Going to be going for that max power with his Scythe.
Washington already taking down first tower in the bottom lane. Good experience boost for them as we move towards more control here. And as, sorry, go ahead, Tim.
No, just talking about the Scythe there. Level 13 build could allow for them to slow down opponents, but Shoyu actually gets engaged on here in the bottom left, and the poison there from Frumgore helps out with the kill as the entire team just looked at Rainer. Rainer is a hero, although he is a mildly robust, he is a hero that if you get on top of, you can focus him down quickly, and he saw that happen right there. But back to Zul and getting the Scythe build here. At level 13, he can pick up a talent that allows for him to slow down his opponents, which will allow for Rainer to kite appropriately. They can actually chase really, really well with that Scythe, so I wonder if they're going to grab
falling
it.
Low. He will get taken out there at the top shrine. Rafflecopter just picking him off. Eyeshine, he's going to have to fall back behind his wall while Gutslug and Rafflecopter own this top lane right now. Both teams just picking away at each other, losing heroes here and there, but no big major moves yet.
Tennessee is making some really beautiful rotations. They're not necessarily sticking to the traditional 1-4, which we often see for the first portions of the game. They're mixing it up, and they're catching Washington off guard left and right. Karazim just went down, but they might be biting back. No, the dragon does get picked up for Tennessee.
A nice pickup here by Tennessee, and they're really breaking in that kill potential they have in the early game with Lunara and Falstad rotating around. Make sure to tweet at Heroes of the Dorm to vote on who you think will win this match. Vote UW for Washington and vote Tennessee, T-E-N-N.
Tennessee getting a lot of value here out of this Dragon Knight. They're going to pick off these towers and most likely rotate to another lane and try to do the exact same thing. About 30 seconds remains on this Dragon Knight. He will despawn at that point and the objective will reset. But it looks like Raffle just content here to continue to push in the mid lane with the Dragon Knight.
The lane clear here for Hot Dogs is it's not very, very strong. Caster is okay in the top, but Thrall, I think, outpushes him in that lane. Rainer is mildly okay, but still he has to use a Q to even be efficient at really clearing a wave. Karazim can work in auto attacks. This is actually a team that was trying to really control the map by just having Zul constantly rotating. But with the constant pickups from Tennessee, you're seeing that tempo that the Hot Dogs started out with really started to diminish here. And it's because Zul is having a hard time moving between lanes. He's taking the safe path now instead of just going through the bushes in the middle.
Yeah, it didn't seem like too much of an issue until level 7, and once Nature's Culling was picked up from Lunara, their lane clear just become infinitely better than it was in the past, and now that Thornwood Vine is on the table, like, that just presses the issue even further.
So Tim, if you had to weigh in, is it the right decision to have Zul in that role versus Manning down the top lane there?
Tassadar can't push as well as Zul can here, and Zul actually getting caught in the middle, so I like the idea, but the execution isn't going so well because Tennessee really threw a wrench in the plans here of Washington. Now the goal for Washington is just to get the 10, because right now they are hurting. They're two levels behind. They're losing their turrets, their wall, taking damage on their forts already here at 6 minutes into the game. Tennessee is looking very, very dominant.
Absolutely, and Rafflecopter, you already saw the Mighty Gust come out, so they're feeling very confident with their control. Washington turning their eyes towards Merc camps and that level 10 that Tim spoke of.
Tennessee can just take whatever they want here, so they're gripping the camps in the bottom right. Washington is trying to grab something on the map. Got their Giants in the bottom left. Rafflecopter waiting around, looking for a rotation. They have a Wisp actually right below Rafflecopter here, so they can see if anyone walks through that bush. If so, he would use Falstaff's Hammering, slow him down, and call for HC to come in for an engagement, and they would probably get another pickoff. Nice positioning here.
Yeah, so Washington has actually gone for a bit of a Wombo style. What they're going to look to do is try to land a money force wall and throw down all this area of effect damage. With the Hyperion and the poison coming out from Zul, that big poison Nova, it can actually completely dismantle the healing that Rhaegar has available.
Seven's right to strike as well for Karazim, so we'll be looking to him to dish out damage on targets in isolation or that ETC, trying to gun him down as well. There we see Washington just clearing out the bottom lane and beginning to rotate. Falstad flying towards the top, maybe looking to try to catch that Tassadar out of position in the top lane.
Also, just looking at the builds for Washington, I feel like they actually have a really good defense for when dragons are actually taken away from them. Washington can actually handle, get a good engagement with a force wall, can land up with a good bone prism. They have Hyperion that can help out as well. And they're just kind of setting themselves up to kind of deal with dragons that come with their way, mitigate through it all, get to late game, and have a ton of marksman stacks for Raynor, at which point the damage should be so much that he can start breaking down his opponents, especially with them having three assassins and Rhaegar, who's relatively squishy too. But it all comes down to the engagements.
That was kind of disrespect in the top lane. Rafael just bullied Charsnix so hard, used Barrel Roll to capture the shrine, went back to base, and, you know, called it a day.
Rafflecopter showing how strong of a player he can be, especially in one-on-one scenarios. Hot Dogs rotating down, wanting to keep control of the shrine. They would like to not give up dragons, even if they do have the tools to get to engagements if it does occur. And you see the team. Every time they go for an engagement, they're always looking at Raynor. They're throwing any skill shot they can towards Raynor. Once again, Rafflecopter getting more poke on Shoyu, forcing the heals out of Terry here as the Shiny and the rest of the crew try to get some pressure. And Mathis, though, setting up for some engagements, and Frumgar will be working in those auto attacks.
Washington still struggling to get their arms and their grip back into this game. Level 13 already in the hands of Tennessee.
Oh no, Sharsnik could die here.
Oh man, Sharsnik keeps getting caught. And
oh,
there
wow.
He goes. He does fall. Force Wall does come out, but there's the Gust to disengage. Gutslug and Rafflecopter will live on another day, backing behind the
Tennessee
wall.
Tennessee is so decisive. You saw that. They baited out the dimensional shift and then immediate sundering from Gutslug. And then here's a mighty Gust. We don't want to fight anymore.
Yeah.
Just like that.
Both Frumgar and Raffle have more than double damage of any single assassin on the side of Washington.
That
is how these two are just putting out massive numbers right now.
All right, taking a look at the vote. We have 64% rooting for Washington, 36% for Tennessee.
That's pretty impressive. That is pretty impressive. You know, Washington is a team that came in here, and they do look dominant in their matches, but right now they are playing far from behind. I imagine going into game number two, a lot of the team will change their opinion on who they're going to be voting for, as Tennessee is great. Here's the engage from Matt. This is going to bring in the power slide. Now, remember, at 13, he will be able to get the talent that will allow him to lead forward. Relentless Leader, I believe it's called, which will actually knock back ETC, so that's a good counter here. But at 13, the Hot Dogs will have to start winning some team fights.
Second Dragon Knight going the way of Tennessee. Rafflecopter in control once again. He is definitely going to set his eyes on these forts and start breaking down this infrastructure. I don't know if you saw that. The damage from Lunara on Zul must have just felt so brutal. She was just chasing him down. His health bar dropped to half. You got to keep an eye on her range. If she has her eyes set on you and you're running away, you're in trouble.
This is so tough for Washington. The moment they're on an even talent footing, there's a Dragonite. Like, almost the exact second. And this Dragon is now going to propel Tennessee up to level 16. They're once again going to have that talent tier advantage. It's going to be so hard for Washington to find a window that's where they're on an even footing.
Well, it's going to keep piling on them if they don't do anything about it soon here. I would love to see some more aggression from them. I know they're still farming the marksman stack. You keep seeing Raynor moving down the bottom left, yeah. Moving to the middle, trying to get that damage. Just now getting Relentless Leader so they can get new engagements if it calls for it. And Tassadar is actually pretty solid against the Dragon, but Tennessee moves to the middle, starts putting pressure in, realizing only two people are here to help defend that fort, working in the auto attacks when they can. Tassadar now walking in. There will be a nice force wall. However, Frumgar will just gallop away.
Nice idea to split push there. They have the Dragonite continuing to do work in the top lane. Just now despawning, Rafflecopter able to barrel roll away and use Gust just to maintain that protection.
He really likes using that heroic ability. He just, every single time,
well.
There's a chance
cool
that there might be an engage.
Low.
Yeah, he's just here.
So,
go away.
Starward Spear now picked up on Lunara. It's going to give her just crazy reach with those auto attacks whenever she pops the spores. And on top of that, we actually have Colossal Totem for the heavy initiation. More control here on this team. And imposing presence on ETC is a direct counter to just about every hero because there's not a single spellcaster.
Yeah, you're not going to be wanting focusing ETC here. They're going to try and ignore him. But the problem is ETC, if he doesn't hit Raynor, can get those power slides, can get those mosh pits available to them. But yeah, you're right. Every single hero is going to want to get auto attacks here from the Hot Dogs. Even Murden, at to a point, wants to be able to work in those auto attacks when possible. So good pickup there by ETC, and Tennessee continues their lead, grabbing mercenary camps in the top right, in the bottom right, keeping up the pressure. Shrines will be spawning relatively soon here, and with the Washington Hot Dogs not having 16, they would love for that to not to be happening sooner. They want it to happen later.
Yeah, Washington still without any significant infrastructure damage on Tennessee as we move towards this late game, and yet still a talent tier behind. Tennessee sits above the 16 mark. Hot Dogs just a little bit below that right now. Picking up the bottom merc camp here for Tennessee. They will begin to push in that bottom lane, and that's where the party is right now. All heroes gathered there except for the solo laners in the top.
Tim, what do you think about the fact that we saw Spectral Scythe have the additional reach at the 20% level 4, but we're not seeing the slow at level 13?
I really thought they were going to go for that. Really just have a major way for Reyner to get in there and work those auto attacks in, slow down the opposing members that are melee. It would be great against Thrall, be great against Rhaegar. Even with him going into wolf form, it would be just enough to allow Reyner to get that focus attack in there and the Seed Marksman stacks in. Interesting pickup here from Zul, but now they can transition to level 16 and get that amplified damage on Bone Prism if they do want to focus a single target, but they gotta hit 16.
Yep, absolutely. And there, both teams just deciding to disengage. Tennessee just continuing to bring the pain to the fortifications of Washington. How can they get back in this game? They do have 16. There's a good opportunity for them to push for that team fight. They have found Frumgor out of position. They need to get that down, but there goes the save from ETC with a nice power slide.
A quick cleanse. That cleanse was almost frame perfect there. I see slam the cleanse to keep Frumgor alive. If Frumgor had been stunned for that full duration, I fear that he would have been taken out. So nice job there by Rhaegar, but that is a cooldown that will be down for a good another 50 more seconds here as Hot Dog is able to get that out of the way.
But you're exactly right, Tim. That is their way back into this game. Look for those pick-offs. Look for heroes like Lunara out of position and clench when you can.
The Gust and the capture of the dragon should be successful. Rawful going to be piloting once again in the massive damage already being done from Lunara.
The Relentless Leader will knock back Math. Math, unfortunately, not able to get that power slide into Mosh Pit, so that gives a chance here for the Hot Dogs to retreat, and they will now start defending here. Start breaking down this dragon. At level 16, the amplified damage was picked for Zul, so watch for a target to get Bone Prison. Gutslug is forced to retreat immediately as he does see that, but the dragon is getting worked down. This is the power of Reyner and heroes that have auto attacks. You can really get rid of that hero if or that dragon if he stands there and takes that damage.
Yeah, you know, I love this play from Tennessee. It reminded me a little bit of ASU's style, which is just slow, methodical, clean. Heroes of the Storm play. They're doing it right now. They're just doing nice, clean work. Nothing overly fancy. They're not risking anything. Rafflecopter, though, he needs to be careful. He is able to barrel roll away and use Gust just for the extra security there. He will get out of that safely.
I like the adjustment. Washington was actually getting ready to engulf him if he could, grab Rufflecopter, but he just really quickly barreled into the bottom right corner and was able to get that full mighty gust off. Had he just stayed in the area he was at, there was actually two people that were spread out on the left, so they could get the engage on him. Nice play there by Rufflecopter, yep. And now Tennessee moves to level 20.
If he didn't punt Murden either, he would have been in a really dicey spot because that Stormball could have come out. But wow, a huge fight going out in the mosh pit on the whole team.
They're just dancing.
Man. So much damage there. Incredible. And the poison damage was doing work, though, for Washington, but they are down two heroes on the side of Washington.
And the Sundering to Sharsnik getting rooted, and that will be a dead Tassadar as well. Rafflecopter will come around. No, he gets away, but Murden does get caught here. Does he have the Dwarf Toss? He does. He will barely run away, but these fights are being dominated here by Tennessee.
Yeah, absolutely. Tennessee standing on the verge of a keep here, and right now Washington has got to feel like this game is slipping out of their fingers. Two of their heroes down for another 15 seconds. Tennessee has the run of the map and control, but the nice pickoff there on Thrall. That was a good turnaround.
Nice play there for Murden in particular, getting that Stormbolt and of course that slam there, really helping break down that Thrall. You gotta kind of wonder if Thrall was unexpecting that damage, because usually when you're playing against two people, okay, we got this, there's five people here, but there is such a thing as being out of position even if your teammates aren't near you.
Yeah.
And that was on full display there.
Uncharacteristic of Gutslug to step forward like that and get picked off.
Terror with the B step.
Keeping up the APM, man.
Yeah.
All right, well, for the Hot Dogs, Washington, they need to get control here. They need to start grabbing map control. They're going to start doing it by grabbing mercenary camps. Here is this mosh pit, by the way.
The money mosh.
Yeah. Very, very solid here. He moves in and just hits it right there. Mosh is in, no power slide into Reyner. Reyner actually walked into it. He meant to turn around and, I believe, actually knocked back the ETC to prevent that mosh pit from happening. And you just see everyone just jump on top of the targets, focus them down, and that was two quick kills there for Tennessee.
Absolutely. Right now, Frumgar's attention on Merc Camps. Tennessee in control of this game decisively. They have level 20 above Washington right now, so they are in complete control. Washington's got to figure out how to get back into this game somehow. They're looking towards the shrines in the top. And if they can get a Dragon Knight this late in the game, that could serve to help them significantly.
It could help them, but you wonder at this point if they're even going to try to get the Dragon. I think the better play here is just to hold down an area, a part of the map, get to 19, get to 20, move your way in. Hopefully someone oversteps, and then you get a pickoff. There's no way for them to split up here. They can't. The only one that I would probably give some chance to do it with would be Shogun. Get on that Murden and walk down. But even then, we've seen from Tennessee, they're willing to pick apart opponents that are a little bit out of position. So you're going to see them group up more than they normally would.
Yeah, we got to highlight two talents that have been picked up here. Forest Wrath, that just gives so much additional range on that heroic ability, the Thornwood Vine of Lunara, and then Epic Mount on Falstad. We've seen Raffle willing to go full ham and fly into the fights, and this enables him to do it that much more often and that much more successfully.
Dragon available here for Tennessee. They're contesting over it. There goes the Mighty Gust pushing everyone away. And Math literally just walks over, grabs a dragon, and says, all right, let's go, team. This game seems relatively easy right now.
Yeah, Washington just feeling like they're giving this game on a platter to Tennessee at this point. But how can they stop? Right now, they are standing on the precipice of disaster right now. But Tennessee just saying, you know what? We're going to play patient. We're going to turn our eyes towards this keep. Take it down first with his Dragonite, and then maybe go for Gore.
Yeah, you don't want to give Washington a chance here to defend. Oh, there goes the Hyperion, though, hitting a few members, and three members for Tennessee is currently taking damage from there. Rafflecopter does float around, does get Stormbolt, but there's an immediate Ancestral. Nice play here once again from Rhaegar. Sharsnik taking some damage, being worked apart here by Frumgar, but a lot of heroics were already popped for Washington.
Yeah, right now, damage being done to the core. The shields still are up, but Math is falling out of the Dragonite. He is the one to be safe on the front line. That is ETC. But Rafflecopter dangerously low on health. He does get stunned out.
He hits it.
Will fall out of this fight.
Nice Stormbolt there from Shogun, who is able to nail Falstead. And now Rafflecopter out of the fight, as mentioned by Kevin. Now two members of the top level are in trouble. I do think we should have seen the engagement on Lunara in the bottom right corner, because we needed some kind of slow on top of her to really help out this team with chasing down. But Washington is now level 20. They are down to two keeps, so they're trying to find some way to get more experience here so they can get some momentum in this game. Unfortunately, not able to grab Frumgar or Rhaegar, as they are a little bit too quick.
I look at the infrastructure there on the side of Tennessee. All forts still up. There is a long fight for Washington if they are going to get back in this game.
Yeah, they're almost climbing Mount Everest here. This is a really bad situation for them. They are very, very far behind, but luckily getting that kill was helpful. The misstep of Tennessee was a little bit too much. Rafflecopter had three teammates in front of him, and somehow the field goal shot from Shogun was just enough to land that Stormbolt on Falstead, which made the entire team crumple pretty hard.
Yeah, but although this is like very far behind for them structurally, I think they have the far better team fight at this point in the game. Now we have Nexus Frenzy on Rainer. He's been farming up the Seasman Marksman all game long, and those autos will absolutely melt anyone on the enemy team. Doesn't matter how powerful that hero might seem. On top of that, we see Bone Spear, which I find to be a bit peculiar. No mortal wound picked up here, which is, you know, often considered to be one of the best responses in the entire game to heals like Ancestral. So we'll see how well that works out, but it does give them just incredible amounts of AoE damage in these team fights.
Shogun getting power slided on here. He will turn around and bring the Stormbolt. Rhaegar did get caught in the bottom right, but Shoyu wasn't able to get the auto attack in there yet. He was actually hit a minute at the time. Followed up with a second attack, got the focus attack, but you see Hammering coming in, slowing down Shoyu. He's trying to run away, and here is a mosh pit. Two people getting picked off, but immediately it will be canceled out. Rafflecopter trying to get a kill. He will land a takedown on Terra, and now with the Mighty Gust, the entire team is sitting next to the bushes. Frumgar comes around, adding in auto attacks as well. Three people should be taken down. I believe the poison will be enough. Yes, Murden is killed off, and now we should see Tennessee just push across the map and finish the game. Nice team fight by them. Jake, here they go.
Yeah, MVP to Raffle. This guy is just playing amazing, and he's allowing Frumgar to put out the most ridiculous numbers in the world. The control he's providing in the fights, that Lunara's damage, it just cannot be responded to, even with a double support.
Tennessee running away with game one here on Dragonshire. The Weavolin crew have this in the bag. Rafflecopter and friends showing how it's done on this large three-lane battleground. Nice work by them. Good gusts from Raffle. Always playing the game, saying, I don't want to play that game. I want to play my game. Using gusts constantly to dictate fights. Get capitalized where he can and get the small advantages here and there, and just eventually build until you have a victory.
That was an interesting strategy from Washington. We've been seeing them the entire tournament picking up heroes that really solidify great teamwork, right? They pick heroes that are individually skilled, that way they can work together and bring in their prowess of mechanics and really break somebody down. But they put all of the entire team fight into Rainer, it felt like, that entire game. And, you know, he started working in the Season Marksman, but it became a really easy target for Rafflecopter just to throw out a Hammer Egg, poke him down, get him out half health, and get him retreating. And the moment Rainer would start retreating away from that entire fight, that's when the entire team would engulf, go in for the engage, and really try to win that team fight. And they did it every single time. So I don't know if that strategy would be something we could see again.
Jake, do you think a hero like Jaina, as opposed to Rainer, would have turned that game around for them?
They just needed to find someone to lock down those big backline assassins. I mean, at the end of the game, we had Oshoyu with 34,000 damage on Rainer for Washington. But on the opposite side, we had Frumgar with 89,000 damage and Rafflecopter with 78,000 damage. That's not even remotely close. Like, the top damage was about a third less than two heroes of your opposing team. They could not do anything to stop that output.
Interesting. Well, right now, Washington's going to be able to dictate where the next battle happens. Do you have any suggestions for them, given their style, on where they should play?
I think a battleground like Tomb of the Spider Queen is good for them.
Yeah.
It's relatively easy just to try to grab the objective as it happens. They're all about team fights, and we've seen it so many times. I did like the idea here. I will mention grabbing Zul, allowing him to kind of carry in the early game, spread out the map, get the rotations going down, and allow Raynor to take over in the late game. But Tennessee was just so good at really putting a wrench in that entire plan, as we see them again, time after time, winning a majority of these team fights. So going into game number two, I want to see a smaller battleground. I want to see a battleground that dictates team fights, and that way Washington can just play their game.
All right. Well, that is game one here. Washington versus Tennessee. Tennessee walks away with the first win, but can they do it again in game two? We're going to find out briefly after this short break. I'm Cloakin with Trixler and Solid Jake. We'll be right back. Hello and welcome back to Heroes of the Dorm 2016. You're looking at a leaderboard of kill-death ratio for Epic 8 teams here right now. Look at this, Boston College, the Stone Cold Killers with an 18 average kills.
Around. Oh my gosh, that's very, very high.
Absolutely. Beneath them, UConn in second place there with 17 average kills. And you know what? All of these are significantly high in terms of kill counts, but you know,
I'm proud to be a New Englander, I gotta say.
Yeah.
Top two. I'm okay with that.
Well, thanks for joining us. My name's Cloakin, joined by Trixler and Solid Jake. Thanks for spending your Easter Sunday here with us and with these remarkable teams that have made it all the way through the 64-team single elimination bracket here in Heroes of the Dorm. We sit at the cusp of the second game of Washington versus Tennessee. We saw Tennessee take the first game over Washington on Dragonshire with just solid, clean Heroes of the Storm play. Falstad being played by Rafflecopter. Nice play. And control, of course, by Mathdiz on that ETC. Nice combo from those guys. Good synergy.
Yeah, Rafflecopter also really showed up there, too. I like the idea from Washington. They're trying to change it up a little bit. Hey, we got different strategies. You can play them well. The execution was just not there. And really, I think they just haven't been a team that can really break that down apart like we saw. Rafflecopter was all over the battleground there. You know, I mentioned that looking at this team, you think it's Rafflecopter and the gang. And kind of Rafflecopter was a star there. He really did a lot. But you're right. The ETC from Math was great as well. We saw some great Sunderings at the same time. They just knew how to break apart that entire composition. So Washington, I need you to pick your heroes that you're comfortable on this in game number two.
Yeah.
No more crazy stuff.
I mean, the Zul got almost zero value, I think, in that game. Like, it really felt like Zul never had an impact. They didn't put him as a single solo laner. They put all these cards into trying to utilize him as a rotation tool, but not once did it work out. And in the late game, his build didn't have the impact. He was thrown at Bone Prison. The hero was either getting away or the Bone Prison was getting cleansed, and it wasn't enough. I don't want to see the Zul again.
If you run that comp again, you ban Falstead. Period.
Yeah,
every
you.
Time they did get an engagement that could have worked out for them, the Mighty Gust just came out every single time and reset the entire fight. Because that entire engagement was kind of an all-in thing.
Mm-hmm.
Bun Prison goes down, we lock somebody down, we go in there, Raynor gets the auto attacks in, Karazim helps out, and we chase him forever with Revolution Overdrive. And then ETC can't come back because we have Relentless Eater. But the Falstad just really destroyed everything. So if you want to run it, ban out Falstad.
Well, we sit on the cusp of game two. We do know it will be on Infernal Shrines in our draft is ready. Let's go take a look at exactly how they're going to implement strategy on this large three-lane battleground again. Already underway here, we do see that ban on Falstad coming out for Washington, followed by a ban on Zagara, and then these early picks. Muradin there for Tennessee, followed by Thrall and Zul on the side of Washington, and then Johanna as the counterpick for Tennessee.
Tennessee is getting some control here. They've already gotten Muradin, they've gotten Johanna, and they've gotten Rhaegar. These are heroes that can engage, but also can stop team fights, especially with Rhaegar at level 16, getting that totem that will slow down everyone in the area. So they're going for more of a control fight here. They realize they're going to be really scuffling around the shrines, grabbing those minions. So if they can hold down the fort, they'll be good to go. Washington, though, does get Zul again.
Yeah, they're taking your advice, man.
They could go for the same strategy.
Yeah.
They really could here, especially with Thrall being taken away. Last time, Tennessee had that.
Right.
Now
they're controlling the strong lane heroes, but what I like even more than that is just the fact that they banned out both Falstad and Lunara, because those were the two heroes that put out just obscene numbers from Frumgore and Rafflecopter, and you're taking them all. I mean, they're definitely strong players in general, but we saw the impact immediately from those two heroes, even at like level two.
Yeah, the numbers don't lie, and what you were saying
man.
About the damage they were doing in that previous game was significant. Of course, bans coming out here on the side of Tennessee, ETC going away, and then followed by the pick on Stitches here.
So now Azul goes for a Bone Prison, and the opposing team walks away. Stitches can follow up with a hook now. So you effectively get engaged no matter what. Zul doesn't have to be so reserved with getting those burn prisons out. So Stitches is a cool pick here. I like it. And it's also a hero that does relatively well around the shrine. He's able to get the Devourer build if he wants to go for that, so he can be tanky. We haven't been seeing it in Heroes of the Dorm, but he still is able to fish around for hooks.
Yeah.
There's a lot of areas that you can hide in fog, you can hide behind walls, and really just drop down that hook and pull somebody in. And Washington is really sold on this Raynor play here, grabbing another Raynor pickup. Will they go Season Marksman? I think it could work out here. However, they're a little bit squishy compared to what we saw last game. Yeah. Zul and Thrall can be picked off if they are caught.
Yeah, it's interesting that Stitch is these... we talk about how the shrine fights can be so long and drawn out, and it's just plenty of time for Stitches to just sort of navigate around the shrines, you know, look for that ideal hook and try to get that pick. So we will be seeing Stitches both cleaning out those skeletal defenders very well, as well as looking for picks whenever he can. And yeah, interesting to see that they're still committed to this Raynor.
This is interesting, though. They've left that support for the final pickup, and I'm curious what Tennessee is going to respond with. They know that they cannot be the Rhaegar. They have him. They're not going to be too worried about Uther being a strong support. And if it's Karazim again, they don't really have to worry about that either. Even with a double frontline, Seven-Sided Strike gets all of its value out of having a single frontline warrior that you can seclude. But it's not really going to be the case when you have both Muradin and Johanna. So I think Tennessee's really won in that regard already.
You know, it's interesting to look. I'm looking over my notes here over Washington, and you know, they did mention having practiced a strategy that involved Stitches and Raynor working together.
Yeah, it's a pocket pick for them.
Yeah, some kind of pocket pick. They talked about how, you know, so maybe we're seeing that here.
You know, we also have to mention the fact that Washington is the home team for the Heroic Four, right?
That's absolutely correct, man. It cannot be understated.
So they have this added pressure of trying so hard to qualify, to be there, to represent their city.
Yeah, it's a big deal. If they can get all the way through this match and into the Heroic Four, that is going to mean the world for them, their support network, their school, everything, because Seattle, Washington is going to be crazy. And so I know those guys really want to show up here in this match here on Infernal Shrines. We're seeing Tennessee kind of taking some time with these last two picks.
Can you imagine the pressure of that? You're going to school daily, and everyone's like, hey, if you win, we'll come support you. You got to get to the Heroic Four. I think I would crumble under all of that. I don't know how they're doing it. But some teams actually get fuel for it. I hope that Washington will get the fuel to the, hey, for the people at home, for the people that are around us, for the people cheering us on, we need to get ourselves out of this game. Go to game number 3 and win it so we can go to the Heroic Four.
All right. Well, we got to talk about this draft a little bit more. Li Ming is still on the table, and she seems like a no-brainer for one of those ranged assassin slots. And Sonya, although that would be a third frontliner, and it's not the most common thing in the world, that would make this such a beefy composition. You've got this huge frontline with that one big hero in the backline. I would love to see Tennessee do something just like that.
Jaina, of course, another solid option as well, as we've seen her do serious work on Infernal Shrines, especially if she gets Snowstorm and increased Blizzard Range.
Is this unkillable? Is this going to be like a Murky or something weird, Tim?
I don't know. I'm looking at it. That would be a little bit of an awkward pick. Murky, I don't know. Murky against Raynor, when he gets 16, he could actually just change his build to do the Stunlock build at 16 and just kind of stun out Murky, and it's so hard for Murky to engage into that. But yeah, Tennessee does look like they're going for muscle here, getting a lot of health, getting a lot of duration to try to break down their opponents over time. And with the Force Walls ability to get the lockdown, I'm considering that Tassadar actually might go Arc on this game. There will be the Vala pickup. Okay.
Double support, double tank, and Vala with the damage.
They can float around, they can bring in the aggression. Rhaegar helps out with clearing the minions up, and Johanna can walk in there and clear that up. So trip the shrine control, they do have the shrine control. The team fights will be a little bit on the rough side if Burnin isn't able to land those storm bolts, but they can make this work. And there's Vala. We've been seeing her a lot this entire game. Reign of Vengeance has been the star, if you will, of Heroes of the Dorm, whenever Vala is able to follow up on those engages. However, I would consider maybe picking up Raynor here, even though they do have, or not Raynor, Strafe, even though they do have Raynor and could knock that out. And Morales will be the final pickup here for Washington.
Interesting. Okay. Of course, we talk about the synergy between Morales, her Stim Drone, on Raynor. When that guy gets all of his damage, especially in the late game, and then you amp it up even more, he is a horrendous.
And this is gonna be really tough for Stitches to be killable. He has amplified healing. I'm sure he'll be grabbing that with Medic. And Last Bite, when you're fighting over these shrines, you have all these little small targets that are easy to get the final hit with your E to get that massive heal for yourself. It makes Stitches a little bit more tanky, and with Tennessee's very low damage.
Yeah. I don't know.
I like both teams for the shrines. That's what I'm looking at here. I'm thinking about the shrine phase.
They're dropping for the objective.
And I think Tennessee will win it in a 60-40 kind of way. They just have a slight edge, but it all comes down to Washington and the hooks that come from Stitches. But there are two targets that or three targets here if they get hooked, it doesn't really matter. Burden, Johanna, and even Tassadar to a degree. So Rhaegar and Vala will be the ones to pick up, but they can play around minions. I don't know. I think Tennessee can win a lot of the objectives, but when it comes to sheer team fighting, especially to the mid to late game, I'm siding with Washington here. This is going to be an odd tug of war around the shrines and who wins in those engagements.
Yeah, and if this game goes the way that Tennessee wants, it's going to be one of those long games on Infernal Shrines. Yeah. That's where they're going to find their strength. Just out-sustain, outlast, and eventually maximize use of the objective.
But the longer the game goes, then suddenly it shifts towards Washington.
That's true.
One, if they go see the marksman with Raynor, and then two, if they get hooks, right?
Yeah.
If you get a hook and suddenly you're in a 5v4, the game could get very, very difficult mm-hmm. for you. But then again, Tennessee showed that when it comes to team fights, they seem to have a little bit more confidence than Washington, which is kind of weird because Washington's been dominating the entire tournament when it comes to actually getting into a team fight. This is going to be a fun match. I honestly can't pick a winner just by looking at this draft.
Well, let's take a look at some of the players who had a significant impact on the previous game. Matt is here. This is their front line. We saw him with incredible control out of ETC there on Dragonshire. Of course, Murden, also a very favorite hero of him. Just solid play out of Mathis, one of those guys that you want to base your team fights around. He has great positioning, solid initiation, and he knows how to open up opportunities for other players like Rafflecopter.
Rafflecopter was just playing with his food last game. It felt like every time he got into an engagement, he usually secured a takedown and then pushed away the entire team. Both things that he just does so well. This guy is really coming together for an assassin player for this team and really showing why he has so much power in this entire tournament.
He commands the fight. He dictates where you go, and he knows exactly when to get a little bit more aggressive rather than defensive. Mighty Gust was used in every implication, forcing people into corners, enabling his allies to do that huge damage. And he's kind of just like a crucial playmaker. He really is like the quarterback of the team.
Yeah, so I'm assuming Rafa's probably going to be on Vala this game.
I would assume so. Yes.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to know what build he's going to go for, too. I think auto-attack build makes a little more sense here. Multishot would be good for kind of controlling it, but they already have so much control with Johanna and Murden and then Rhaegar's Totem in the later game. I kind of want to see an auto-attack build with Executioner.
Oh, that would be interesting.
And then just slowly mill through people. Kind of similar to the comp that we saw last game with Washington with the Raynor working in, but now Vala has a little bit more speed there because she's able to get the hatred stacks up and really work in those auto-attacks. That would be really fun to watch if it did work out.
All right, well, the game is ready. Let's jump into it. This is game two, Washington versus Tennessee. Washington's tournament life is on the line here. Can they hold on to it and push it to a game three? We're going to find out right now.
Alrighty guys, on the blue side, that is Washington with iShiny playing Thrall Terror on Morales. We've got Oshoyu playing Raynor, Oshogun on Stitches, and Sharsnik playing Zul.
And on the red side for Tennessee, this is Weavolin, Gutslug on Vala, BYD on Rhaegar, Mathis, Johanna, Rafflecopter Murden, and from Gore Tassadar. So Rafflecopter taking up the front line here.
All right.
Interesting.
See the marksman also, by the way, for Raynor. So they are going to go for that late game Stitches, hooks landing whenever they can, and then really dominate team fights with farming all the marksman stacks.
All right. So yeah, Rafflecopter on the front line. This is not something that we have seen in this tournament. I mean, of course, he's had a ton of experience with a variety of heroes in so many different situations. They've clearly got something in mind here with this composition.
I want to know if we're going to see Haymaker in this matchup.
Yeah.
Because when you put these assassin players, these playmaker-type players on a hero like Murden, that's what they like to do. They like to get in your face and force you out of position.
Yeah, there's also two really juicy targets for the team of Washington that they would love to knock back with the Haymaker if we saw Rafflecopter get behind them. That is one Morales, she has no escape, and then Raynor as well. The other targets, Zul, I feel like, could survive long enough to not get focused down, and Thrall has a Sundering to stop the disengage, but Raynor and Morales, if they get picked off at any point, that's effectively the team fight for Washington, and they'll have to wait till they respawn.
All right, so we see just the 1-4 setup here with those rotations happening between mid and bottom lane right now. Tassadar and Thrall up there in the top. I know Shogun with a nice hook on Murden, but of course the Dwarf Toss, easy to get away. Rafflecopter does that and moves on.
And that'll be the story of the game. We're going to see Murden always positioning in a spot where he sees Stitches,
sure.
So he could be the one hooked and just Dwarf Toss away. You probably won't be seeing Dwarf Toss to be an aggressive engagement until a team fight has already been won.
Yeah, that is the target that Tennessee would love to be on the receiving end of Stitch's hook. And of course, Stitch not really super interested in Murden being his target. Probably looking more for that Vala, someone on the back line like Rhaegar as well. iShiny, BYD just holding it down. We're seeing both teams just focusing on the experience gain here in the early game while the top shrine activates in about 10 seconds.
So it really seems like we're seeing a full-on just objective style play out of our friends at Tennessee. Multi-shot build for Vala. We have reverberation level one for Muradin, and they're likely going to continue to build entirely into that area of effect damage to just get the last hits on the skeletal defenders.
And that's okay. It's okay to approach the battleground in that regard, especially when you know your opponent's weaknesses are really focusing on the objectives. If you take it for yourself and you own that part of the battleground, all you gotta do is make sure you don't lose team fights handedly, and from there you can slowly just whittle your opponents down. Tennessee, already here on the top. We have Mathis in the bottom left trying to peel out the entire team. Johanna just being so unstoppable here. The hook will miss on Gutslug, allowing for the team to peel back. But we see Hot Dogs, the Washington team, just moving in here. Rafflecopter coming in from behind, though, looking to put pressure on Terra. And Terra is getting focused down. All members of Tennessee turn around and start focusing here. She starts to retreat, though, with a nice safeguard. Mathis in trouble, but it looks like this team fight is starting to slowly tilt here to Tennessee. Rafflecopter body blocking the members into this back corner here. Sharsnik is focused down. Shoyu in trouble as well, but one more member, Stitches, is right above.
Man, and you see what a priority target that medic is for Tennessee. Rafflecopter just went for a long hike to body block her and ensure that kill, because that is the lifeline for the entire team on the Washington side. If they can take her out, they're absolutely crippled.
That was a really sloppy fight by Washington. You can tell they're a little bit shaken up from game number one, and they're gonna have to just kind of take a step back, take a deep breath, and think about this and just correct their positioning for future fights.
Definitely got to agree with that, Jake. Especially the Minic there, that situation. He came down the bottom left of that shrine, which set her up for the plate there from Double Warrior. I think if she would have gone to the top right instead of above Rainer, they could have won that fight. So I agree with you. A little bit on the sloppy side here, and they cannot make mistakes like that, especially here in game number two. Tennessee, grouping up, keeping the pressure here. Once they grab this wall here, a quick Punisher goes to them, and then after that, they can take their slight lead that they've gotten, about half a lead here, and just keep moving forward. Race to level 10.
Of course, if you're at home and you are new to Heroes of the Storm, what you just saw was the objective phase on this battleground. We will see those fights around the shrines occasionally throughout this match, and first team to collect 40 of those skeletal defenders, take them out, will incur that Punisher you just saw. So keep that in mind. Watch the lower right-hand corner when the objective comes to life again. And of course, if you're out there and you want to show your support for these teams, head on over to Twitter, use the hashtag Heroes of the Dorm, or hashtag UW, or vote hashtag vote 10.
I'm kind of curious.
T-E-N-N.
Yeah, T-E-N-N.
Double N.
I'm kind of curious if we're going to see more votes for Tennessee. Because in game number one, Washington was just coming in looking like the team to win it all. But then after the team fights, it really felt like Tennessee came today prepared. And now I'm honestly giving them my vote right away, because I feel like Tennessee, when it comes to execution, has just been a little bit more on point than Washington.
Yeah, we have to talk about these builds a little bit too. In game number one, we actually saw the additional range on Spectral Scythe. And I'd say there's even more of a case for that here when it comes to the objective, just fighting for the skeletal defenders. Well, they're mixing it up. We're actually seeing Sharsnik go for the mana retention at level 4, and he's actually going for the heal at level 7. So whenever they're getting the raise of that trait on those skeletons, it's going to give tons of resource regeneration and retention on Zul.
It actually kind of makes sense a little bit, because whenever the shrines do spawn, the shrines are actually very clear or close to the mini waves, especially in the middle and the bottom one. So if you ever need to dip into some health, you can have Zul just go clear a wave and suddenly he's full health again. It's an interesting build, and one that can work out for him if he never gets focused down. A nice hook onto Frumgor, but even Frumgor, who is a target that you would love to grab, he can just immediately turn into a wolf. There's no immediate lockdown. You see him just run away freely.
Yeah, and on the contrary side, when you saw them, all four of them focusing Stitches, he is such a beefy target. He can just waddle away and get out quite safely. So, but of course, as these heroes gain power throughout the late game, they're going to gain more effectiveness against heroes like Stitches. So, but you know, you mentioned that, Jake. I imagine we're going to see him specking. In fact, he did into the amplified healing. He is just going to be a tank.
Yeah, I mean, amp heal with last bite. Last bite's probably the best talent he can get, specifically on this map. We even have Frostwolf's Grace on Thrall, so they're going for mega sustain style versus mega sustain opponent.
Rafflecopter just goes for the flank every single time. At some point, we're going to need Washington to be aware of that. Terror is being focused down, an immediate takedown. That poor Morales, I feel so bad for her. Washington, at some point, is going to say, you know what? We don't see Muradin. Flank isn't coming.
Yeah.
Look around, grab control, check the closest bushes before you even attempt to go in for a fight.
And that's one of those sort of baked-in abilities here in Heroes of the Storm that you just can't undervalue, the power of the body block. Rafflecopter just showing he's willing to put his body on the line. Just Muradin going in there to be a big wall. against the opposing team.
Yeah, especially when they have Tassadar up there as a shield, and they also have Mathis on Johanna. Any point that the three members of Washington were to turn around and go to Focus Muradin, you see Johanna to start moving forward, grabbing the Condemn and pulling everyone back towards her and says, let's fight here. Ravnica once again.
The roaming wall.
Getting focused down. Shoyu trying to bring in the damage, but he still has his Dwarf Toss. He says, all right, well, you caught me. See you later.
All right, well, just about enough. Skeletal Defenders picked up. Only three more needed for Tennessee. Not too far behind is Washington, but I don't think the Install is out there trying to desperately do it. But it is picked up, but not before Johanna goes down.
And Gutslug is really working on the auto attacks here, trying to make Washington pull away. But they do get the Punisher, which is a big win here for Tennessee, grabbing whatever they can. And we're going to see more pressure once again from Tennessee as they move towards level 10.
So one thing I want to point out is I'm seeing Rafel and Frumgore today in particular be a power pair. Last game, it was Lunara Falstead, two completely different roles. But together, they had immense synergy. And we're constantly seeing this Rhaegar throw the Lightning Shield on Rafflecopter, diving in with him. They're being like dive buddies and working so well together.
Yeah, and you know, I think you're exactly right, Tim. This comp is all about the roaming wall with Rafflecopter. They're souping him up, putting that Lightning Shield on him, saying, hey, go body block, go put some control in the way. We'll keep you up, and it's working really well so far.
Everyone's still believing that Washington will win here, 53-47%, though. Tennessee has gotten the vote of confidence from a few more members. Johanna just now picking up Heroic, getting Blessed Shield. That really aids her more in the whole, hey, guys, stop looking at my Muradin, and here's a Blessed Shield stun you out, balking in there, start working her auto attacks in. Reign of Vengeance will also be the pickup. So again, control is still the name of the game for Tennessee. The good news for Hot Dogs, they do have Sundering now, which means Washington can turn around if we do see an engagement and they're able to lock down Muradin. They can sunder out the opposing team and focus down Muradin and get a 5v4 advantage. And that's where Rainer with Stimdrome will start to excel very, very well.
We have to talk about the walls falling there in the mid lane for against Washington. Tennessee really starting to put the pressure on. They're going to be dealing damage on that keep shortly, especially with the next spawning phase of the Immortals. That could spell some serious infrastructure damage for them.
Aggression here on the bottom. Stitch is going to pop the future bio. Rafflecopter actually did use the Dwarf Toss to go in. The Reign of Vengeance will come out. They're focusing down Shogun with as many auto attacks as they can. But Shoyu does get the Stim Drone, and this is where the fight starts to break out here for Washington. The Sundering had knocked about three people. Here is a Bone Prison as well on Johanna. I believe she's already used her Iron Skin, and she will be taken out. Washington comes back with a great fight there, and the key component was Sundering.
Putrid Bile did a lot of damage to start, but the Sundering and then the Poison Nova was just too much whatsoever for them to even consider healing through. Beautiful execution there on the side of Washington, taking their first fight of the game.
Yeah, that's the kind of team fight Washington wants to set up and capitalize on this entire game. You're going to have to get through a lot of hit points on the team of Tennessee. Not just hit points, shields and health. And here we see it, Rafflecopter doing what he's been doing, jumping in deep, but getting surrounded, relying on the sustain from his team. And they did just that. He got the Ancestral Heals, but then we saw that Poison Nova come out and the Sundering, like you mentioned, and so much damage.
And I like Morales sneaking around there, getting the safeguard on Rainer, giving him the Stim Drone, and helping out with the heals. So yeah, you're right, great fight. I would advise Tennessee to be careful in those chokes, I guess, especially with that Poison Nova that we saw so strong in that area in the future bio, but now we're having a fight over the shrines here.
With level 13 for Washington first. This is the first time in the series where they've been ahead and they have Smathness completely locked in, forcing out that Blessed Shield.
Still have a heal available here from Rhaegar, but he doesn't have Ancestral for 13 seconds. So you see both the supports here panicking frantically to make sure they keep Math alive because they need him for whenever the heroics do pop up. But now, Tennessee having a majority of the heroics. Peter Bile is not available. Hyperion and Sundering just did come in for Washington. And Volin looks like they may have to fight here at a level of disadvantage. They will start retreating. There is a Sundering. However, it doesn't really do too much. The Bone Prison comes out, but there is a hook. It is on Rafflecopter. He will just Dwarf Toss away. And now Tennessee can start moving back and get to an engagement. Three heroics were used there.
I think they finally have themselves.
They figured this out, I think.
Yeah.
You see Sharsnik positioning as sort of like an anti-Muradin there in the bottom right now. Just keep an eye on Rafel. You just see him doing the exact same thing.
It's awesome.
Yeah, yeah. And I think they've clearly figured it out at this point and are starting to address it directly. And right now, we see the Punisher in the control of Washington starting to rain down havoc here on this upper lane fort. He is going to take down these towers and start wailing away.
This Bone Prison is huge. Ancestral does connect, though.
The Reign of Vengeance will hit three members as well, but they're not getting any kills here. Terra really starting to come together here with his heals, keeping all of his teammates alive. Math and the rest of the team are going to be forced to retreat. The hook will miss, but that is still a win for Washington. They get a fort and they get pressure on the top lane. This is the first fort of the game, and it has been awarded to Washington.
Yeah, it really feels like Washington's starting to turn it on here now. They sit on the cusp of the top keep wall, getting down a tower, even more experience. They're now a full level lead ahead. This is looking very positive for them.
That it is. So what do you do here if you are Tennessee, Jake? What would you give as advice for them?
They just need to try to find like their way to engage. And right now, it's really tough because they have so little damage. Muradin needs to find Medic out of position, but we've seen Terra really correct his mistakes from the early game and not be out of position nearly as often, playing far further in the back line with the crazy sustain. I think this is so tough because of how little damage they have for their team.
And they've gone all in on that sustain thing, choosing sustain plan, choosing Avatar over Haymaker. You know, you almost wonder if they'd have gone the Haymaker route and he got those flanks and able to throw Morales back into the waiting grasp of his teammates, if they'd have been able to do something with that. But they went full on tank mode.
I agree with the plan that Jake had at the very beginning of the game. Get the Haymaker and knock somebody back. You're going to have to knock them into your team. Knocking away a Morales far enough is 2 to 3 seconds that you buy for your team to go for a full engagement and allows Vala to get the auto attacks in. But Avatar will be the choice here, which will allow Robocopter, to be fair, to be a little bit more aggressive and stay in the back lane, but he still has to be aware of that Poison Nova. It is a massive amount of damage, especially with so many melees being here for Tennessee.
I'm a little surprised we're not seeing more prioritization into the Lightning Shield of Rhaegar. I feel like that would have helped supplement a lot of the damage output, especially when Muradin's really in that front line, being a bit of a bully to Washington. And with this full chain heal style, it's like, sure, it's hyper sustained, but where's the damage?
I think the thought process behind that is we've been seeing Washington, whenever they do finally get into engagement, Sundering, Hyperion, everything all at once and drop it off. And you see Tennessee, they start retreating. Look at this. They start pulling back. The Ancestral is a little bit too late there. The Reign of Vengeance is popped out as well, but that is going to be a lost team fight here for Tennessee. But I believe the idea is get everyone to pull back, top off again, and go for our flank once again and get the engagement. However, it did not work for them there. But you saw four heroics were immediately born within the span of 5 seconds just because Washington is so ready, so trigger happy to win their team fight.
But it's kind of working for them. I mean, right now, you just saw it. Like they're basically just pushing Tennessee back and getting run of the battleground.
Yeah.
They might not be winning full on crushing team fights, but they got complete map control as a result.
All right, Ravnica coming from the side here, going once again on Terra. Now this is a 4v5. Johanna is just now spawning. Ravnica will retreat. And Terror will once again turn around and heal our teammates up. Ice Shiny and crew turn around wanting to get to an engagement. Gutsluck, by the way, who went to the multi-shot build, is low on mana, which means that build becomes a little bit on the useless side here until he gets more mana. And now one more fort will go down. H Ryan is activating, and Washington has a commanding lead.
We've got to talk about Pulverize being the option for level 69 Stitches rather than the Fishing Hook. And I honestly have to commend this decision out of Oshogun because his hooks have not been on point at all this game. So just, you know, knowing what you like, just control the fight, spec into Slam a little bit more. It's very good for the additional clearing control, and it will work out so much more, often, I think, for this team.
Tennessee going for more passive play here. They're going to soak to level 16 and most likely give up this Arcane Punisher. They will probably lose their fort because of that, but that's okay. You can lose the fort, especially in the late game. Keep the keep alive and you keep yourself in the game on a relatively even battlefield. So the full shrine will go to Washington. They now have the Arcane Punisher and they should ferry it forward.
Yeah, here you see Tennessee rotating to the bottom lane to address this Punisher as quickly as possible. They need to absolutely get it down as quickly as possible before losing health on this fort. Right now, Washington in a very good position here to continue to push their lead. This is the last fort that stands on behalf of Tennessee.
It's the last fort, but Tennessee, their plan is coming together. They have double Executioner with Earth Grasp, and this is going to give them exponential amounts of additional damage on this team. Oh, but the Ancestral on the wrong target. That is a big deal.
Very unfortunate. Gutsluck will get caught there by a hook, and the Sundering to try to help secure the kill. A Cleanso was great, but the Punisher says we have one more thing here. Robocopter will barely just get away, but yes, the composition is starting to come together for Tennessee. The multi-shot build applies the slows, and then from there, we'll see the auto attacks from Muradin and from Vala start to shred anyone in their way. But the problem is, this entire fight looks like it's being dictated by Washington and their engagements. They're doing such a great job of keeping the pressure up, and they're not giving a chance to Tennessee to really come in and disrupt anything.
Yeah, and I'm sure Tennessee's probably feeling they wish like they were on a little more even battleground or standing right now this late into the game. They clearly had a late game strategy here with this build going for full executioner, but right now being a level and a half down here, actually full two levels, over the Washington, it's not exactly as positive as they'd like.
Washington is actually split up here. Rainer is just down the bottom left. Here comes a Storm Bolt. It will hit Zul. They're trying to chase him. He does pop his bone armor. We do have Rainer and just moving around to the left corner here. Now, remember the last time we saw Tennessee here, they were in this huge area idea of area effect abilities. They need to be a little bit careful. Luckily for them, Raynor and Medic, as well as Thrall, just do not have their heroics, so they will be able to retreat. But be careful when you're in the area. Don't chase too far, or we'll see a huge Poison Nova once again.
Absolutely, and of course, that totem there for Rhaegar is going to mean all of the source of damage that's going to be coming out of those Executioner damage dealers. So that is so crucial. Rhaegar's positioning, his ability to get that totem down so that they can benefit from those talents is going to be a very big deal. Right now, we see some skirmishing happening. There goes the Putrid Bile, and the Reign of Vengeance already dropped. There goes Poison Nova as well, and the Sundering following.
The Poison Nova hitting 4 to 5 members here. And it looks like Mathis is really trying to put the aggression on Terra, but she is fully good to go as Sharsnik is doing such a good job of peeling the Murd. And this team fight is going to Washington. The Poison Nova was fantastic.
So Tennessee had a really good plan there. They dove in with the Raffle, they locked down Terra with the Storm, but with the Reign of Vengeance barely missed, and now they're sitting with 4 heroes down. This could be game.
Gotta kind of wonder if Tennessee needs to start maybe trying to bait out more heroics. I'm seeing Dwarf Toss a little bit premature here from Murden as he tries to really move in and land that Storm Bolt and try and just get the kill quickly on Morales. And Morales at this point is literally just dropping the safeguard on herself and negating a majority of that damage. And then suddenly you see Tennessee just go full in on trying to get the engagement. Maybe a little bit more baiting, a little bit slowing down here of the fights, get one or two heroics and then retry the full engage.
Both teams seem a little bit trigger happy with their heroic abilities and probably could show a little bit more patience. Rafflecopter waiting in deep, but look at this. Washington, all 5, turning their attention to the complete fort here in the bottom.
They have Murden locked down in the bottom. They've got him completely secluded. Raffle gets picked off. This is a huge misplay by Rafflecopter. And that could spell death for them in game number 2.
That Bile was so good from Shogun. He didn't get any damage on it, but he zoned out the entire team because they couldn't walk across a carpet of green goo that would have destroyed them. And now Tennessee is forced to help defend against us, but with Terra keeping up all the heals and all the members and the auto attacks coming from Shoyu, they're going to melt this core with their level advantage and the Poison Nova. Washington fights back, and this is now a 1-1 series. We're going to an ace match.
All right, Washington still in it. They hang on against the long-sustained strategies of Tennessee. Wow, what do you guys think? Do you think that was the right approach by Tennessee? I mean, they clearly had the plan in mind.
Yeah.
It just didn't work out. They were up a game, so why not pull it out?
The thing is they took their level 1 to 10 strategy and applied it to the late game, and things change when heroics become a part of the game. You have to adjust and make sure that you are working differently, because the opposing team, if they catch your tendencies, you can punish that. Even a team that doesn't have as strong a heroic that we just saw there, if they see the same tendencies, they can adjust their own play. This game is all about adapting all the way through level 1 and all the way through level 20, so I would have loved to see Tennessee play a little bit differently, but I like the strat overall.
How about you, Jake? What do you think?
Yeah, it just felt a little bit too weak to me. I don't think they had enough damage. I think their composition was overall okay, but if they had gone for builds that were a little bit more aggressive, a little bit more emphasis on just damage in general, maybe it's just static charge there for Tassadar. Maybe it's 1 or 2 talents into the lightning shield of Rhaegar. I think it could have made a big difference in the long run.
One of the biggest differences that was made by Washington here, though, was Terra. As you see these fights, at the very beginning, she's always getting picked off. But Morales didn't get picked off anymore after that. Always peeling backwards, getting out of range of Tennessee. And you just saw them just kind of walking the damage. They're trying so hard to get rid of that Morales. Focusing Morales, although might be a strong play at rank 20, at rank 1, up in the higher ranks, you got to calm down a little bit. Make sure that that's not the only thing you do.
Absolutely. Of course, Tennessee getting to decide where the next battleground takes place. What do you think is a smart choice by them, given their tendencies as a team? Where do you think we're going to see this next game take place?
I think huge maps, huge battlegrounds,
yeah,
where they're able to kind of just be the stars that they are, the individual mechanical players that can pick people off and work together in tandems of 2 rather than a team of 5. We saw that. We mentioned it earlier. We saw Rafflecopter and Frumgor just really working together all the time all across the map. More stuff like that. So Cursed Hall could be a great pickup for this team.
I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but Infernal Shrines is Tennessee's highest win rate battleground.
Oh, wow.
So they just lost on arguably their best map, and that doesn't feel good going into a game number 3.
Yeah, Sky Temple might be a good option as well, another large battleground with some good rotational needs there. So we will find out shortly. Of course, that was game 2 in this series of Washington versus Tennessee. They're tied up, and we're going to the third game. Stick with us. We'll be right back on this Easter Sunday with Here's the Dorm 2016. Welcome back to Here's of the Dorm 2016. We sit at Game 3, Washington Hot Dogs versus Tennessee Wee Vollen. This has been quite the matchup between these two stalwart teams. Who's going to take it here in the Epic 8 and move on to the Heroic Four in Seattle, Washington, April 9th and 10th? Both of these teams, I know, want this so badly.
Yeah, you want to get it because you go to the Heroic Four, you go to Seattle, you have the chance to win some new computers, and you also get the chance for college tuition. All wonderful prizes. They all start coming in after today's matches. So looking into it, I think Tennessee, if they play the way they did in game number one and they make sure that they're adapting, unlike they did in game number two, they can take the series. I'm starting to float to them a little bit more. The more I watch them, the more I like them. However, Washington, again, we've been saying it throughout the entire tournament. This team is solid. They know how to win team fights, and they do it handily all the time.
Of course, we found out that the next battleground will be Battlefield of Eternity. So how do you think this looks for both teams, given their play styles?
Stylistically, I think this is actually pretty even for the matchup. But yeah. Washington, they got to be feeling good. They've kind of shook off those early morning jitters. Yes, 2-3 p.m. is early morning for us here in the gamer world. And going into this game, they're just feeling confident. They know it's just one more game, and they've secured themselves that spot in there. Their home turf for the finals.
Absolutely. Battlefield of Eternity, one of these battlegrounds. We got four mercenary camps. You saw the big open area in the middle. That's where Washington and Tennessee really thrive as a team. So it's going to be it's going to come down to the muscle. Who can etch each other out slowly but surely and really get those small victories that, of course, will cascade into a large victory.
Yeah, and of course, heroes like Falstad that we saw be so successful for Raffle in Game 1 could serve to be equally as successful here on a large battleground like this.
I think we'll see the same bans. Yeah. I think we'll see Falstad banned out early once again. If you give that to Raffle, that's a mistake on the side of Washington. And if Frumgor gets Lunara, again, huge mistake because Lunara is a monster on this battleground.
Yeah, especially, she can float around and just deal so much poison damage.
Especially if we're not going to see double support at Washington. They seem to really stay away from going for double support. They like damage. This team is all about assassins. You know, going into the round of 64, they were the team that had the most assassins ever played because they would play nearly three comps or play comps with three assassins. So if they don't want to change the way they play and play double support or go for maybe double warrior and just try to muscle their way through, they're going to lose every single time against a Lunara. So I think the ban is correct, Jake. I think we're going to see some Lunara bans.
Well, let's jump into the draft here. This one going to be on Battlefield of Eternity, Game 3, Washington Hot Dogs versus Tennessee Wee Vollen. We're actually well underway here. Looking at Falstad as the first selection here for Tennessee. Bans coming on Li Ming and Greymane, and then response happening with Zagara and Thrall on the side of Washington, and then counterpick there with Rhaegar on the side of Tennessee.
So Washington got a huge comfort pick with Zagara here. We know that the Zagara player is very patient. She's very, very solid at sitting in the back line and is waiting until a huge mistake happens, but Tennessee luckily has a tool to deal with the mistakes, and that is Rafflecopter's Falstad.
Man,
here, so
I can't believe it made it through. I can't. And if they let Lunara through as well,
Yeah, to be fair, Greymane getting banned out is one of Tennessee's favorite comfort picks, but Li Ming on this battleground, man, in the middle of the map, if she can hit any of those orbs in a scenario where the Immortal's around the area, you can really just chunk down an entire team, and then you can win that Immortal phase right away. So I understand the ban of Li Ming, but I think I agree with you, man. Tennessee, when it comes to playing Falstad, they know how to utilize him to his full potential, and it's very, very painful to deal with. Hopefully Washington will make adjustments this game and find a way to get to Falstad and the rest of the team.
Mid bans are out. Sonya being taken off the table by Washington, and then Tyrande, the follow-up from Tennessee. Of course, Tyrande.
Super smart.
Yeah, those are smart bans indeed, just by these heroes' effectiveness. Tyrande, of course, with Hunter's Mark, can just absolutely wreck the Immortal phase.
I'm all for this. Lunara, I've been talking about Frumgor on that hero, and I was so worried for Washington letting that through, but at least they pick it up themselves. So that is a nice relief. And that hero, and when it comes to a race on these Immortals, I certainly give it to Washington based on the current layout.
Yeah, Thrall and Lunara will melt it, and you got Zagara's summons. Hydralisk will break it down as well. And then Karazim, he ain't so bad himself, man. His fists are pretty darn powerful. So Tennessee will have to find some way, A, to get a comp that allows for them to engage, or B, some way to actually go toe-to-toe here with Washington when it comes to that Immortal races. Because you're right, Jake. Right now, Washington's looking much better in the draft this
week. Yeah.
Will we see Zul on the side of Tennessee? Some sort of presence there, known for sustain, known for that lane presence. Will we see something like that come out of them?
It's not a bad pick.
Yeah.
I'd be all for the Zul, honestly, in this situation, because they do need the strong solo lane. They need to be able to push the lanes out quickly. And right now, they don't necessarily have any strong lane clear at all. Double Warrior can certainly work if you really want to work on bullying around the Immortals in the late game.
Oh, but 13 Lunara starts shredding Warriors. That's such a scary way to go. I don't know. I think double support might be the best here. Or they match with the three assassins and go for blow, bring in damage like crazy.
But who has the burst? I mean, Sonya, Greymane, they're both banned out.
Jaina can be good here. And then, you know, Volve's been working in. I know we've been talking about Volve the entire tournament, and people are making it work because of that Reign of Vengeance. And she does hit pretty hard with those auto attacks.
I almost want to see Illidan Apather at this point.
Yeah? I think, okay, it could work. It
huge sustained damage. With that hat, you get the additional attack speed from Apather hat, and Illidan starts to shred through the health bars of the Immortals. Also, he's phenomenal at chasing Lunara, and you can force him to force her to grab Leaping Strike.
He is phenomenal at chasing Lunara and getting into the backline, but the problem would be, when you get an Illidan on your team, you immediately start getting into this tunnel vision of, you need to keep him alive.
Yeah, but
him,
what are their stuns? What are their stuns? Guess what? They have
Thundering, they have Devouring Maul.
Okay, that's decent, but it's not like the mega lockdown that he's so scared of.
I think the main point that you're going for here is you really want to get some way to get back to Lunara.
Yeah,
that's what you really want.
I
think the only choice that Tennessee has here is to go for some kind of double warrior. Honestly, Zeratul could work. Zeratul could work. I would love to see Shen. I know. I'm going to go off. I know you went a little bit off the bridge, and I'm going to jump all the way off of here, man. I'm going for some chin, dude. But Zul and Ball will be the pickup, so they are going to go for some lockdown here and a little bit more damage. But I think Washington, if they get a strong warrior here, Johanna is on the table. They can really dictate how these fights go.
Yeah, and Zul's Poison Nova, as we've seen, it is just so nasty in those team fights. And if he can get all up in the middle of the opposing team, he's going to really bring the pain for sure. Vala as the last pickup there for Tennessee. And then looking at Washington, they're going with that Johanna frontline.
All right, well, Johanna will be the last pick here. So overall, if you're looking at the draft, Jake, I think I'm leaning a little bit more towards Washington, though.
Oh, 100%. Yeah. 100%. Look at their initiation. Sundering, Maw, Blessed Shield, incredible, powerful, and control. And when you have that kind of initiation with that much control, Lunara just starts to do way too much damage. I mean, she can pump out some of the highest numbers in the entire game, but she needs the safety. She needs the control to be able to do so.
And this composition isn't a composition that requires a good engage, like we saw in game number one with Dragon Shire. Washington has multiple ways to engage now, too. They're so versatile, and they're not going to have to worry about Falstead as much anymore. In fact, they could probably put pressure on Falstead, get out of Mighty Gust, and then work towards taking over the battleground at that point. So I like the comp. It's strong.
Yeah, keep in mind, Washington also completely owning the vision game here in this draft as well. Obviously, the support from Zagara, Lunara's Wisp. I mean, they have vision unlock.
Yeah, that's a huge point. That's actually a really big deal on this battleground in general.
There's so many things to balance, and I feel like Washington has got the resources here to take on almost every single factor. They can do better team fights, they can focus down the Immortals, they can have the visions, so they can control the entire battleground. We're going to need a star game here from Tennessee.
Yeah, right.
We're going to have to really work on their weaknesses here and make it, take the pros they do have and make it work out well for them. The strong, mighty gusts are going to have to be great here. We're going to have to see really strong engages from Muradin.
I think that's exactly it. Rafflecopter is probably the strongest player in this entire matchup, right? Out of all 10 players, I would put him as the rock star. And he's on Falstead. He's proven that he can absolutely dominate and just bring the win for his team. And I think that pressure is completely on him for this game number three.
There is one more thing we can balance out of all this, though. There is the other heroic that Falstead has, the Hinterland Blast.
Oh, wow. Listen, that would be so cool.
Listen, come on, team. Give me a second here. There's a majority of assassins on this team for Washington, a lot of low health bars. Hinterland Blast, there's a lot of areas where people naturally group up.
Yeah.
Hinterland Blast is a linear skill shot. You hit 3 to 4 people. You can take him out. There's
You're a funny guy, here. Tim.
Hey, man, hey, I'm just saying, it's up there.
Do you
it's
guys
possible.
Remember Hinterland's Blast like, was the star heroic of last year's guard, right?
Taco.
Bring it back. Come on.
Crispy taco.
Was Gust even an ability at the time? I think he still had aerial blitz.
That's probably true.
I don't know. I think it could actually work out here, and it could be a surprise. You know, you could throw off the opposing team, you know, get a really fast engagement at level 10, take out 2 or 3 people, and suddenly you're winning an Immortal phase. And that could be enough to propel you to go through the mid to late game to keep up with that. It is a relatively large cooldown, but it does bring in some damage. It is impactful heroic. It could totally change the way the game is played here. Actually, something different, you know?
Yeah.
It would be really, really cool to see a different play happen here in game number 3, and it's do or die, so why not?
Let's waste no more time right now. The game is ready. Let's jump into it. This is Battlefield of Eternity, game 3, Washington University versus Tennessee. One of these teams is going home right now. Tim, introduce us to the first one.
On the far left, it's going to be iShiny, Terror, Shoyu, Shogun, and Sharsnik. Representing the blue here for Washington, the hot dogs are moving forward. On the very, very far right side, let's see who this team will be.
Oh, we got Tennessee with Gutslug on Vala, BYD playing Rhaegar, Mathdiz on the Muradin, Rafflecopter, the star himself playing his Falstad, and then Frumgor on Zul. Can he do that big, massive damage on this specialist? We'll find out.
All right, well, we're going to see the fight for the middle. Usually Zagara and her team will win this this engagement in the middle as they're trying to get down those creep tumors, get that vision, try to lock down a lane. And Tennessee wants to spoil the plans if possible here, floating around.
If you're out there on social media, head on over to Twitter. Use the hashtag Heroes of the Dorm and vote for your favorite team. Is it hashtag vote you Washington or is it hashtag vote TENN? We want to hear your thoughts. Let us know.
And it was relatively close, actually, the vote last time. I think it was 53-47, and I think that's totally
fair. For good reason, yeah.
Yeah, these teams are really bringing their A game, and they seem to be evenly matched. Even though we started to see Tennessee fall apart in the last game, I think that was more of their comp more than their skill. And here in game number three, they can make it work as well as Washington. It's anyone's game.
You know, this battleground in particular, always interesting to note the strategies that come into play during that immortal phase. Do you go all in on your opposing team's immortal? Do you defend yours? What do you think the winning strategy is for both of these teams?
Well, the big benefit to Tennessee is they have Falstead, who can actually hang out in the lane a little bit longer, potentially getting a full additional wave for his team. And he can always use that flight to get right in the battle when he's needed the most. So I want to see them utilize that as often as they can. But at the same time, Hot Dogs of Washington, they can really just kind of poke, and play very safely. The Hydralisk, the damage from Lunara in general is going to add up so quickly.
That it will. Well, our teams are now starting to grab pressure here in the bottom. We see Zagara floating around, really getting those creep tumors and really trying to make sure that they have the battleground on lockdown. That's what she does so well. Shogun, I like the way he's kind of floating around behind here just to keep the eye on Shoyu. While Shoyu is doing all the mechanical attacks here, working in the damage, getting that poison spread, and Shogun is there to back him up at all times.
And look at the creep tumors already in place to kind of control vision around this immortal phase. Right now, we see Washington just positioned around their immortal to defend, and Tennessee pushing in for the aggressive position.
I like the play here from Tennessee to just move in and start putting damage on the immortal, because they do understand that the opposing comp for Washington is better when it comes to the immortal phase. So if you start putting pressure on the immortal and you get a head start, that forces Washington to come defend, which means they can find maybe a storm bolt, get a quick engage, get some poke in there with the hammerangs. But now you're going to start to see, as Washington is putting a couple members towards their immortal, they can really start shelling away here. Falstead, though, is a little bit too far. Rafflecopter will be forced to barrel roll away while three members for Washington are in the bottom left, just trying to defend any pressure.
You know, Jake, it looks like they're doing exactly what you mentioned. They're utilizing Falstad's mobility to soak the lanes, even during a phase like this immortal phase. They just sent him up there, he soaked the wave, he came back down, and they're still trying to do work on this immortal.
Yeah, but Tennessee, they're really kind of commanding the early stage here for this first immortal. They have a good lead on the damage, and they force the entire team of Washington into a defensive posture. This is exactly what you could ever hope to do. But that whole layout, this whole immortal phase is going to look rather different once we see Lunara hit level 7, because that's when Nature's Calling comes into play.
Yeah, and that is just absolutely ferocious against these immortals. So much damage coming out of Lunara once she hits level 7. So yeah, smart on Tennessee to try to take whatever advantage they can in this early game.
Yeah, that's where the poke really comes together for Washington. You're right with the Thornworn Vines at level 10. Until then, Lunara has to kind of work in her auto attacks. And so far in the early game, Tennessee was actually winning the poke game. Falstead was hitting 2 to 3 members with every single hammering, and then also we saw Vala really bring out the multi-shot as well.
This is a mistake. They're unless they get a kill immediately, which they might do.
Nope.
I don't think this is going to work out. Usually, it's always better to just utilize your time to try to race through the health bar, even if you think you're not going to win. Like, I don't think they can control this long enough to make this happen.
Yeah, it feels like they're trying to do two different things really well instead of doing one thing really, really well, which is kill the Immortal. They're trying to put three people in one area, whereas Tennessee says, okay, we'll just keep putting damage on the Immortal where we can work it in. And however, Lunara and Thrall can be good at burning down an Immortal, but by themselves, it still does take a while. I would love for Washington to realize that, you know, their entire comp as 5 can melt these things really quickly, and now they're in a situation where they have to defend here because Tennessee is winning it.
Like, yeah. If Lunara was just staying back and focusing in the Immortal, this would have been far more beneficial, but she keeps coming back, and it's not really getting anything done. They're just stalling the inevitable.
And we have to point out that when you go all in on defense like this, you're leaving the health bar of your Immortal up while the opposing team is whittling down and eventually going to take theirs. That means it's going to have an even stronger shield. So sometimes the most winning strategy here is to just go full-on offense on the Immortal so that you're ensuring you're in a good position when those Immortals do go into lane.
I feel like Washington just doesn't want to lose. But it's okay to take
a
step back. Well, I meant like lose the entire game.
Yeah, but this phase.
I wouldn't want to lose either, right? But yeah, they do get a secure takedown here. They're taking some people down, but they're afraid to lose this phase of the Immortal phase. It's okay to lose it. You have Crazy Poke, you can burn the Immortals when the new combustion, and the most you'll lose is mostly your turrets. But they do get a takedown. The kill's
really good.
Yeah, Ravnica taking some damage. I don't believe Shogun can finish.
Frumgore's gonna die.
Down the bottom right, is he getting a little bit aggressive here? Frumgore is being poked down. Oof. There is a slow from Crippling Spores working in the auto attack. The Wolf tries to walk
can
away,
he
but
tap
I don't know.
The well.
Oh, no, I'm, so
I'm
close.
Basically the miss clear of these.
Water.
I knew he was
it's die. Right there. As we see Shogun, Terror, and them finishing up with the defense, and we did get some more damage finally to the left. Ligara and Lenara and Thrall went and took out the Immortal, and they did get a little bit more health off of there. But I felt like that entire phase was way longer than.
Wait, oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Results are in. 56% still backing UW here in this last game. 44% voting for Tennessee. Can they take it all? Right now, we're evenly matched. We do see an Immortal here pushing for Tennessee. They are going to get some of these towers, some of the experience. Otherwise, though, very even game right now.
Karazim is also picking up Healing Ward. Will be a little bit helpful around those Immortal phases to keep your teammates poked up. But remember, those can be taken out really quickly, especially against Hammering and then Multishot being able to clear that up. And the bottom lane, we see a lot of these members trying to break down this Immortal phase, and they will lose a couple of turrets. This is kind of the punishment of losing that Immortal, but they should be able to save their boards.
All right, well, this Immortal made it through the wall. Nice bit of experience, which will give Tennessee level 7 first, but the massive damage from Lunara, the flank here out of Oshoyu, is doing so very much damage.
Yeah, really, absolutely. Tennessee just having to retreat. The power of that poison can really instill fear in your team. They're going to tap the well, get back into it, start soaking lanes, and prepare for the next Immortal phase. Of course, Mercenary Camp's still available to both of those teams, and Washington is turning their attention to the bottom camp right now.
Yeah, I like how confident Shoyu is with working in those auto attacks. He, at the moment Murden missed the Storm Bolt, he just kind of walked right past him and started working in the attacks.
Yeah. So Cleanse was picked up by both teams. I think this is absolutely crucial to talk about, but Nature's Calling is now on the table. We talked about this. That's 200% additional damage to non-heroic targets. So that means structures, heroics, minions. Goodbye, Thrall.
Yeah, totally caught out with the Bone Prison combination with Raffle there. So much damage, he was like halfway into his base, halfway behind his wall. Just didn't count.
Yeah, back to the point that Jake was making here. The level 7 talent is really strong for Lenara here. So she can really help out with killing the Immortals. Now, I hope that they change the way they pace around the Immortals going into the next phase, especially with having that talent. Just because, again, Lenara can really melt them down. I want her to be auto-attacking those Immortals as much as he can until it is dire that she has to be with her team for a team fight.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty easy for her to rotate whenever needed. She's got a very fast movement speed base, so that should be easy for her to do.
Solid
right now, though, she's kind of
Math
a little
here.
Bit deep here. Math is trying to body block Lunara.
The Hammering?
Take her out of the fight. Hammering does not connect. And Terror, Oshoyu, blue team trying to retreat.
Oshoyu dodged the Hammering, and we saw Terror just barely get out of there with a Radiant Dash. Great response for them with that aggressive rotation from Tennessee. Now that flight's on cooldown for a little while, a kind of an option that's been removed to soak early on here during the Immortals.
Tennessee is a little bit ahead here in experience, though, and with Ballstab having that fly ability, although he did just use it, he can't go to a different lane here and start grabbing that that experience to get them to 10. And now we see Tennessee actually going straight for the Immortal, and Washington got a little greedy IMO.
Well,
they moved over here and they grabbed the Mercenary Camp.
I don't think they had a choice since they had to hearth back to base, but picking up that Mercenary Camp is definitely kind of a gamble.
Defense again, right here around their Immortal, all five of them ready to defend. Lunara there totally putting on the pressure. We're not seeing her focus the Immortals like we thought we may with her Nature's Culling, so interesting.
Yeah. So Washington is forced into a defense here because they did have to back and heal up, as Jake mentioned, and they did grab the Mercenary Camps, which slowed them down just a little bit. The good news is they can get pressure finally in the bottom lane from grabbing those Mercenaries, and as soon as they see Ballstad down there, they should probably start rotating towards their Immortal and get more damage in, and they are starting to do so with Zagara and Lenara. The blind is helpful here, slowing down that pressure from Gutslug. Bun Prison is coming out, and we see Johanna just move again. Shoyo with the rotation too, applying that poison wherever possible, slowing down
Tennessee
the members.
Tennessee is so close to 10, though. They need to back away. They just need to do as much damage as they can to the enemy team's Immortal, concede this position defending, and just minimize the shields that will exist for Tennessee's Immortal.
Yeah, right now Tennessee turns level 10. They have the heroics, and there you see Washington backing away. They know they can't stand this fight, so they're going to deal as much damage as they can, but there it is. Immortal phase ends. Tennessee, another Immortal in their possession.
They're doing a better job as rotating the map, period. Washington has the tools. We talked about it before. We felt they had a better draft, but they're not able to execute the way they want to because of going back to Hearthstone or making a poor choice in decisions of defense like we saw in the early game phase. And I think the second phase was a little bit more forced. They, of course, had to go with the defense because of how they were a little bit behind. But you would love for them to be in a position where they can play this comp to its full potential.
Immortal pushing here in the top lane against the Fort of Washington. It is going to fall eventually. Shield still up, just now falling. He will move into melee range to continue the damage on this fort. And Tennessee looking really confident right now as they continue to push in this top lane, taking down towers and wreaking infrastructure damage.
Yeah. Vala is, he's looking for the flank right now. Vala has scouted him. They are actually scuffling in the middle, but iShiny needs to be careful. Rolfle's rotating around, and now he is very much caught out, and he will definitely be falling here.
Wonder if Shine is going to be using his Sundering here. Oh, the Renovage does miss, so now the Sundering is actually worth it.
Oh my goodness.
Nice attack there. Will get Matt to put back into the Wolf, and the rest of the team is showing up. Can Shiny live? He cannot, but he may have baited the opposing team into a large Devouring Maul. The poison will go off, but two members are low on health here, and it will be a one-for-one trade, but I can't believe iShiny lasted that long.
Yeah, wow, what an awesome turnaround by Washington with that clutch Devouring Maw. That looked like a horrible situation where Thrall was going to get pulled out, but their team responded so well, and what could have been a complete disaster for them, they actually got a counter kill.
And you know how Tennessee actually would have gotten that kill and won that team fight if they had not lost their Reign of Vengeance.
They threw that so early.
They threw it so early there. Had that occurred, you save the Reign of Vengeance for whenever the opposing team comes in, and you throw it down, finish off Thrall, and go from there. That's kind of a lesson on how heroics can be so game-changing, and how not having them available to you can hurt you more than it actually helps.
But here's the question. If the stun of Reign would have actually hit, would that have changed everything around entirely?
Yeah, that is true.
Sure.
They would have stopped chasing. I feel like actually after missing the Reign of Vengeance, they stopped chasing that.
So it not maybe it wasn't the wrong call to use it, but it just was there weren't enough pixels. There was too many pixels, I guess, is the right way to put that.
Alrighty, well, I mean, that does actually kind of catch Tennessee up, though. Even with the trades, they forced the issue. They took out a fort, and they do have almost level 13.
So Boston's behind.
This opportunity to make a big play and show you the worst target to get blown with that, but the palm does connect.
Does save him. Nice palm. If Terra would have been thrown back there as well, that may have been a different scenario. So luckily he did get out, and now Washington will turn this around here. The Sundering, I kind of like it. Whatever, they're trying to keep everyone back there, but it might cost them here. Shiny is forced to pull back with the rest of the team, but they did get a fort, so there is a one-for-one trade. Unfortunately, though, Tennessee has pressure in the top lane here for Washington.
Yeah, and all heroics on cooldown, meaning all game-changing heroics on cooldown for Washington. Tennessee looking really strong right now. A lot of their big heroics still up, but their health bars are pretty low. Math is sitting below 50% right now as they enter this immortal phase. Rhaegar doing his best to heal them up, while it looks like Washington is taking a defensive position around this immortal with Zagara trying to clean up that top lane.
And it's going to get harder for Math, too. When Lenara starts hitting 13, starts hitting level 16, she can really start peeling through her opponents really quickly, especially Warrior. Shogun doing a really good job here of being annoying, trying to pull everyone in. Devouring Maw is now available here for Sharsnik. Keep an eye on him. We'll see if he's able to land that heroic. Three people are grouped up into the Condemn. Two members are picked off. Terra will use the Divine Palm on himself there, but Thrall will be dispatched up as he was unable to get healed up.
That Poison Nova too.
Monster damage from it in that fight. That was probably the most valuable Poison Nova of the entire tournament.
Yeah, you saw they went for the dive. Poison Nova is like, do not dive. Go away right now. Oh, that's so cool, man. It is just such a powerful heroic and completely change a team's mind when they're like, now's the time we go on. No, now's the time that we retreat. There, right now, Tennessee with full control of the Immortals area here. They're going to go ahead and recruit yet another Immortal to their possession that will continue to push against the fortifications of Washington.
You know, that was kind of a little sloppy from Washington because they could have had one member soaking that bottom lane to get level 13 much more convincing, much more quickly. They didn't have that for two full fights now, and it's cost them exponentially in this game.
Well, the third Immortal is going to start pushing down the bottom left. What else will be the cost here for Washington? As we're going to see this Immortal move down the fort. This is pretty much a guaranteed fort here for Tennessee, but we'd love to get as much poke in as you can here so you can prevent the damage from going to your key. But Washington,
watching
around here. We're watching Rafflecopter. He is behind. The flank has got to be huge here. He wants to hit Thrall and Zagari here. Johanna's a little bit farther away from him, which means she can't engage. And there goes a boss stun. Another member being taken down. Shiny low. Gutslug giving chase. Will he be able to get over there? Oh. He's got the slow just barely. One auto attack will secure that kill, and two people have been taken down for Washington.
That disruptive gust absolutely threw Washington off their game. They did not know the bird was in the smoke.
And he went for a high risk, high reward strat there. He actually barrel rolled past Johanna, so Johanna went have the ability to turn around and use a Blessed Shield or condemn the opposing team, which meant all the squishies were a buffet for Tennessee.
Can they go win here?
No, they're not.
It's
going
not to. Worth the yeah, risk, not. But like, what did we say? We said Raffle was going to have to make the magic happen with Falstad. I mean, I even went as far to say that they should have banned Falstad just because the threat that he presents. And constantly, he's forcing Washington into these really bad scenarios. They wanted to just defend passively, wait for that moment. They were probably watching for the flight. But Raffle, he's just too good, man.
He's everywhere. I mean, in that hat, there's got to be a rabbit, because you're right. He is pulling magic out like crazy. This guy is being on top of the game here, and he's doing some high-risk, high-reward strats, but hey, I can't fault him. He's making it work.
Yeah, absolutely. And, of course, it's all on the line for his team, so reaching for every tool in his toolkit to pull out the win here for Tennessee. Washington, though, game is not over yet. They do have one keep still standing, and they're not out of it.
They're not out of it. That is very correct, especially as they move towards a level 16. Lunar damage starts coming in off as well. We're able to get more hydras in the mix here for the Washington player Zagara. So again, pressure on the top lane, grabbing everything they can here. Tennessee taking this lead as much as they can to try and maybe start with some pressure on that keep, because there is only one keep left in this game. They take that down, Catapult is in now both lanes, which means that you put Washington on a timer each immortal phase.
Yeah, and here we see both teams ready to come and collide here in the top lane. Oshogun waiting in on the front line. Oshoyu putting in the poison damage early. If she can continue to get her stacks, float around on the outside, that poison damage adds up so quickly.
I mean, you say ready to collide, but I don't think Washington is. They don't have 16. The last thing they want is a team fight, so they're just kind of lurking around waiting, and Tennessee is constantly forcing the issue.
Yeah, that is actually a very good point. They are doing their best to just hold back the wave.
Yeah.
So Tennessee, though, waiting for this immortal spawn, they're ready to recruit the pushing power of this objective and then go for the win.
I'm watching Washington. I want to see their next move here. They're sending a few people to the top left to start putting pressure on this opposing team, but you should see a couple members start moving down to the bottom and get 16. No, they're actually going for a bit of a race here on the immortal, which is fine, actually. They're going to get to the halfway point where the immortals will go through and fight in the middle, and then they can rotate down to the bottom and get 16. Grab 16, come back, and then assess how they fight.
I'm so glad they made that call. This is the first time they've actually said, you know what, we can't defend. We cannot prolong this. We just need to try to trade out because we had a full shield immortal last fight.
Yeah. That last immortal had. There was no damage done on the part of Washington to the immortals in this phase, and that really hurt them.
The lead for Tennessee works out from here as they get another phase. But you saw it was much closer that time. They actually went into the race. So you can see the power of that comp. It does come together. It can work out for them.
Right. I mean, it almost seemed like they drafted to be able to do that. And it's been so odd that all game long, Washington hasn't been taking advantage of their massive power potential to burn through these immortals.
All right. Well, now that that's a back, can they defend the key? That's the main question for them. If they have anyone die, then it suddenly becomes, can we defend the core? So they have to be careful here, and they have to be methodical. Let's watch and see how Washington will defend here, as they are definitely on the back foot.
All right, positioning just happening here. We know the engagement's going to take place around this keep. The immortal shield's almost down. They do fall. He will push into melee range. Right now, Tennessee just positioning. Watch Rafflecopter. He may pull for some more of those gust strats, so watch for an aggressive fly. Maybe he's going to go that route. Right now, immortal almost falling here to the damage of Washington.
The keep just gets annihilated there, and Tennessee is okay with that victory. They got a keep. Again, more pressure for them. They'll wait for the next immortal phase, and from here, they just keep out their lanes pushed, and if they get a chance, if they have anywhere where they can get a mighty gust, they'll go for it, but I imagine the best play for them here is a move to level 20, get that huge power spike, and then fight around the next immortal phase and secure the game.
Exactly that. No unnecessary risks are needed right now from Tennessee. Just play your game. Play exactly as you have been. Run around, control the lanes. If you can find someone out of position and rotate quickly with Falstead, fantastic. But if you don't see a guaranteed kill, do not try to make anything cheeky happen.
Now, Tim, talk to me about the mindset of Washington. What are they thinking about? What are they looking for? Where is their moment to capitalize?
Their mindset is, guys, we're only a level behind. You look at the positives here, not the negatives. You know you're behind. You look at the things that you can make work for you. If we get to 20, we do have a strong comp. If we can get a solid Devouring Maw into an engagement, we can work out. If we dodge the Poison Nova, we can win this team fight. So you're looking at all that stuff. Here's the ifs. Now, how do we make those ifs work out for us? So watch for the hot dogs.
Watch Eye Shiny. Right,
we actually have Eye Shiny going for a flank here, trying to get the engage. Gutslug will actually dodge that Sundering. Nice play by him. And Rafflecopter just resets the entire fight. Poison Nova.
Oh my god,
destroys everyone here. Shiny getting auto attacked right away from Rafflecopter into the hammering. And that fight that looked mildly decent for Washington turned into a devastating fight as Tennessee is going for the chase, securing more takedowns. This has got to be the win.
Yeah, absolutely. Tennessee just showing the power of appropriate use of those heroics right at the right moment. Poison Nova once again just wreaking so much havoc, especially in combination with the Reign of Vengeance. Tennessee is going to take this match. They are moving on to the Heroic Four. They will get their flights to Seattle, Washington. They will get to show the world on the big stage just what they have in store.
Washington trying to hold on here, but I just don't think they have enough, especially with Lenara being taken out there. Two major things happened in that fight. Gutslug dodging the Sundering, and then the Mighty Gust was important. Congratulations to Tennessee. They didn't even need level 20. They won the game.
You know, I hate to sound like a broken record, but they finally found their moment. They went in for the Sundering flank, and Falstad, once again, just foiled all of their plans. That was the story in Game 1, and that was the story in Game 2. Falstad's Mighty Gust was just too much of an issue for them to do anything all game long.
Hard to fault Ice-Shining trying to go for that flank.
Yeah, of course. It's the right
call. A solid
call.
Sundering flank could have just absolutely wrecked havoc.
Yeah, you want to fight them before level 20, but Gutslug, if we ever got a replay on that, you could see him just immediately, oh, here comes the Sundering. I'm going to sidestep this, and then I go back out, and then the Mighty Gust came in for the kill. So, looking at the replays here, you see the Poison Nova doing so much work. This is actually a really good fight by Washington where they were able to get that engage because of Ice-Shining's escape from Tennessee, but then this is where the Poison Nova was doing so much work. Falstad and the rest of the team was able to follow up in certain scenarios. They kept winning the Immortal Shrine phase, which is what I felt Washington built this entire team comp to do. You got to the late game or the mid game, and there was no creep anywhere. There was no more vision available, which meant Washington had to take gambles in certain scenarios, walk into certain bushes. So a few mistakes from them really started to cost them, and Tennessee just kept the momentum going into the mid game, into the late game, and then with that last final fight, they secured it.
All right, well, we are standing by with Gutslug on the winning team side of Tennessee. Gutslug, congratulations to you guys on this victory here in the Epic 8. How are you feeling?
We are feeling great. That was a tough match. Easter Sunday, like, man, feeling good.
Well, you guys pulled it out there. Nice strats using the power of Falstad, the power of Poison Nova, Reign of Vengeance as well. All of those heroics working so well for you in that last match on Battlefield. How were you feeling, though, coming out of Game 2? What was your thought process? Obviously, we saw you go with a strategy, very, very huge double tank, double support strat there in that second game. What do you think wasn't working for you with that strat, and how were you guys changing your mindset coming out of Game 2 going into Game 3?
All right, in Game 2, we somewhat suspected the Morales, but we thought that the Muradin and the Johanna would be able to interrupt her enough for us to get the kills, but it just wasn't happening. They were able to turn and engage on us too hard. We just able to out-sustain us in our huge burst window. And so that really got us. We suspected the pick, we thought we had it countered, and we just didn't.
Gotcha. And how did you change your mindset around going into Game 3? What were your thoughts?
Game 3, we've practiced a lot on Battlefield, and we feel really good about rotations onto the Immortal. Like you guys might have been able to see, we were able to get a pretty significant lead in that race almost every time, maybe every time. Yeah. And that's just something that we felt really confident in, and we wanted to make sure that we could do that. And having the global presence with the Falstad and the disengage with the Falstad, which is huge for those Sunders and Maws and stuff. We didn't feel like we were too scared letting those go. But we were scared of letting the Gray Man go because the Gray Man is so good at chunking that Immortal down in his own right.
Well, I got two things for you, Gutslug. First off, congratulations to you and your team. And second off, introduce us to the guys behind you.
Yeah.
Is that your teammates?
Sure,
who are they?
Yeah, this is our general manager, Merton, right here.
Nice, yeah, Merton.
This is BYD. He was playing from the library. The library internet was cutting out. I said, come over, man. Play on my land. We got it.
See, we weren't telling stories there.
Very cool. Well, congratulations to you guys. That's all I want to say. Well played. That was a great match to watch, and thank you for allowing us to watch you guys in this tournament.
So how impactful is it to have a sixth pair of eyes and a sixth brain helping you guys with the drafts and shot calling? Like, Merton seems to be like a pretty big asset for the team.
Yeah, Merton is definitely for our scouting the team and stuff. He really helps us know what we want to do, know what heroes we want to run, stuff like that. But as far as the shot calling, he just is more like a morale person, he's not really able, because he's just watching my screen.
Sure.
It's just the same thing. Everyone, you know, he can't see where they are. He can't really, I can't hear him with my noise-canceling headphones, whatever. So, but in the encouragement, like after that loss, he got on my mic and said a speech for everyone. Like, it was, you know, it's really helpful to have that sixth man really holding us down.
Well, fantastic, Jay, to you and your crew. Congratulations on making it all the way to the Heroic Four. You've got a good window of time. Take a breather. Plan your strategies as you head into Seattle, Washington. We can't wait to see you there in person. I'm going to shake your hand. Congratulate you there myself. Good luck on your preparations, and we'll see you in Seattle.
All right. Thank you.
See you.
Very, very awesome. Well, for you at home, we didn't forget about you guys. We would love to invite you to join us at the Grand Finals for the Heroic Four and, of course, the actual finals itself. Experience at Century Field Link Event Center. There is more tickets available. Generation is free, but there are prior tickets for $15 that you can grab through Ticketmaster. We'll be giving away all sorts of great prizes to attendees, and Blizzard just announced if you buy a premium ticket to Seattle, you can be randomly selected for a VIP backstage tour for you and a friend. So
yeah.
Get on top of that. Check out heroesofdorm.com. For more information, we can't wait to see you. We'll also get shake your hand as well, too. Just none of the players, even the viewers, get their hand shaken.
All right, well, let's take a look at where we stand today with our bracket right now. Two of our matches in the bank. Tennessee moves on over Washington. UConn moves on over Cal Berkeley, the reigning champs from last year. They took them out and we'll move on. We still have two more matches to go, though. UT Arlington versus Boston College and Arizona State versus East Carolina. So much more Heroes of the Storm to come. We're going to be right back after just a brief break. Please don't go anywhere. Happy Easter. Stick with us. We'll see you soon.